WIFTBPN.
Chicago's Power Hour.
Yeah, yeah,
I'm
yeah.
I'm your host, Angie Mims, and
Terrence Keys,
TD, aka Terrence Daniel.
Do you believe that God's gonna turn it around?
I got to.
Def.
Why?
Why? Because He's did it before.
Come on.
And He'll do it again.
Yes.
And
yes.
You can do it again.
Yes. Yes. Come on.
Come
here.
On. I better leave that alone.
Somebody calling you right now.
Somebody calling you right now. If it ain't one thing, I better go. God's going to turn it around.
And I feel like we have to encourage the people because so many people are just truly depressed. Mm-hmm. They're going through the holiday blues. And we want you to know that you don't have to be discouraged.
Discouraged.
But you can, in fact, be encouraged because God's going to turn it around.
God's going to turn it around. It's me again.
God's gonna turn it around.
I'm calling on you. You did it before.
In green pastures, he led me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. God's gonna turn it around.
Come all the way with me.
Listening to the most dangerous show in the morning. This is What's In It for the Black People Radio. Maze Jackson. Maze Jackson, the most vociferous advocate for black people in the world.
For Ruthie Moore, for Ty Stroger, I am the host of the Maze Jackson Show, asking every single day, what's in it for the black people? If you don't like it, you can still tell them, Maze said, Mayor Lightfoot, man, we ain't accepting that. We ain't accepting that. Let's go. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's get down to business and go ahead and address the facts. Mayor Lightfoot seems more lesbian than black. Rahm Emanuel's another case. He was just as tired. 50 closed schools left much to be desired. Police had Anjanette naked on that body cam. They suppressed the footage so it couldn't touch a lot of hands. Reminds me of that 16 shots in that cover up. Both of them similar, so I went and dug it up. George Floyd killed, a lot of riots happened in the town. Southside burned and they wouldn't let them bridges down. Grandmother sick, need a prescription and plus a couple groceries. You gon' have to travel just to get it now. COVID-19 out here shutting all the business down. Not enough SBA loans to even give around. So many failed businesses that you could put them in the pile. If you don't survive the pandemic, it's gon' sit you down. We sing, dance, play ball, entertain and crack jokes. Government invested black neighborhoods with crack smoke. System to milk is so bad, we got lactose. Still trying to find out what's in it for us black folks. We sing, dance, play ball, entertain and crack jokes. Government invested black neighborhoods with crack smoke. System to milk is so bad, we got lactose. Still trying to find out what's in it for us black folks. Shout out to Willie Wilson, hope one day you get to Senate. We need some different players in the game to handle business. Too many shady characters like Madigan and Block. But when you really break it down, it's typical Chicago. City full of gangsters, it's what the land was built on. Same streets with hood legends, DNA get spilled on. Carjackers out here lurking, trying to get they steal on. Looking for a block to put them Hellcat wheels on. Let this give bogus appraisals a red line. Car crackers out here getting minimal fair time. And I'm concealed carry, I stay with the pipe. But Illinois gun laws giving minimal rights. Stay up on the swivel, make sure I'm moving tight. Check all of my mirrors when I pull up to the light. Pick my homie up from out of town, man, he caught a flight. He was hella nervous, told him, shorty, this a way of life. We sing, dance, play ball, entertain, and crack jokes. Government infested black neighborhoods with crack smoke. System to milk is so bad, we got lactose. Still trying to find out what's in it for us black folks. We sing, dance, play ball, entertain, and crack jokes. Government infested black neighborhoods with crack smoke. System to milk is so bad, we got lactose. Still trying to find out what's in it for us black folks.
Wake up, Chicago. Wake up, world. This is the Maze Jackson Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my co-host, Miss Ruthie Moore. Ruthie.
Yo.
Hey, yo, Ruthie.
Go ahead.
I see you still in my swag. I see you got your vest. I see, you know, today I was in the closet, but I was getting dressed in the dark, so I couldn't really put my vest combo together.
My mama got me this for my birthday because she said I could match Maze.
Ruthie, when was your birthday?
It hasn't happened yet, but it's in February.
Oh, that's right. That's right. We got to write that down. So, look, Ruthie, I see you got your, you know, that's my swag. That's my new look. You know, I told you, I get me one look, and then I buy, like, five of them.
You can't have turtleneck.
Right. I got the turtleneck. I got the turtleneck vest. Hoodie. She even got the boots on.
I bet you going to say you invented the turtleneck, Maze.
I didn't invent it, but I brought it back. I brought the turtleneck back. You know what I'm saying? I brought the swag back. All right, so yes, come on, how you feeling this morning?
Good morning. I'm feeling good.
You feeling good? All right. Well, let me tell y'all what. We got to take the soul plane down south. Now, we got to take a short hop. We got to take what they call a short hop. So, well, we ain't going to take the soul plane. Okay. I think we're going to head out to B. Coleman and we're going to jump a private jet. Mm-hmm. And we're going to put the G12.
Okay, we're ready.
G12, all right, if we switch up, we're going to jump to G12, and we're going to jet on down to Peoria. We have rocking with us today, I don't even know exactly what to call, because she got so many titles now.
Say them all.
All right, well, state representative, deputy majority leader, as well as president pro tem, pro tempore. I don't know, I always get that wrong. Is it pro tem, pro tempore? I don't know what all of it, but we're going to let her tell us what it is. Live with us this morning is the new deputy majority leader and presidente, Madame Presidente. You know, I got the presidente down because I'm already like the first gentleman of the water. Right here with us today is leader Jahan Gordon Booth. How you feeling this morning?
Good morning. Good to be with you today. It's early.
You know what? It is early, and I was surprised to get you to be able to come do this with us. And then to say, look, I was like, now, look, you know, we had Representative Cam Buckner on yesterday. He's the leader of the House Black Caucus. He's the House Black Caucus whip. And I didn't think he was going to get up because he be faking out. Remember, he faked us out on Monday. Yeah. So then I reached out to Leader Booth because I was feeling all kind of swaggy when I saw the paper come out. I was like, oh, look at all. I was like, it would really be awesome to have the deputy majority leader and president pro tem. And you got to get me right. Pro tem or pro tempore?
Pro tem.
Okay. President pro tem. Oh, speaker pro tem. That mean, let me tell you. So I'm gonna tell you, I always tell you in politics. It's not the person that's got the big the head title that you don't want to see. It's the number two. Because the number two is the one that come to punch you in the mouth.
Oh yeah, I don't right?
Like they stand up, you know, like they get up, the speaker gonna get up in front and be like, yes, we're gonna make this happen and we are doing this for the good of Illinois, and then the deputy majority leader comes by, everybody don't get in line, get punched in the mouth. So shout out to leader Jahan Gordon Booth. She's gonna be rocking with us the whole show. She is gonna be sitting in for Ty Stroger, who is still out on the beach. Todd is like out on the beach. I'm saying like Todd was like, look, I think he was the smart one. He was like, I'm getting up out of here while this whole transition happens. And when I come back, hopefully everything will be all good. Now, how do I address you officially in this conversation? You know, I like to call you JGB. That's like my nickname for you. But obviously, as I've stated on numerous occasions, I want to make sure that we give you your proper props. So how should I address you today?
So in this, Jahan is what my mama named me. So that's always appropriate. Then there's Rep Gordon Booth. There's okay. Leader Gordon Booth. There's Speaker Pro Tem. So I'll answer to any of them.
Okay. Well, you know what? I'm going as is my tradition. I will definitely give you the props that come with your title. I would like to call you the President Pro Tem, Speaker Pro Tem. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to probably stumble over that trying to talk fast as I do sometimes. So I'm going to be somewhere in between leader, rep, and presidente, and we're going to get it all right. But we know that you are. Look, I'm going to tell y'all, and I'm looking forward to this. I am looking forward to the reconnection of our community to our political class, because I think, as I have been hollering from the tops of the mountains since Monday, I saw years ago I became the executive director of the Illinois Legislative Black Caucus because of what I saw last week. Unfortunately, I was not there to be a part of that, but it was the, in my wildest imagination, and I believe you got a dream to be able to even conceptualize what happened. So it's not like I keep saying, it's not that I can't believe what happened, because it's what I have believed should happen for years mm-hmm. and years. And so I'm excited to see us even be able to have these conversations. Just think about this, y'all. We've been doing this for 5 years. 5 years, and in 1 week, we got the Speaker of the House, the Illinois House Black Caucus Chair, and the leader, and they all black.
Come on.
All in 1 week. So I want y'all to recognize the seismic shift in power, and I think it's something that we're going to have to learn to deal with. But I'm excited to have you here. So thanks for joining us today. I know she also reminded me this morning or yesterday. She was like, I was like, 3 hours. She was like, you know I'm a mama, right? You know I got to get the kids ready for school. I got e-learning. Let me back up. Y'all know that Rep Gordon is down in Peoria. We're going to get into that a little bit later at 7 o'clock. But are you all e-learning or are you back in school?
Hybrid. We're doing both.
Okay, hybrid. And is your daughter going, she's doing both?
Yes, she is. So still on, it's twice a week, Tuesday, Thursday, and Fridays every other week.
So I am going to tell you that.
Wait, that's another title to add.
Right.
I promise you.
Well, that's what she led the whole conversation when I was asking her to do this with, you know I'm a mama, right? Just like that. Like, I got the text, and she is like, I'm a mama, right? And so I think this is going to be I think it'll be a good conversation because it's going to add some perspective. I think it's pretty cool. I think when we have all of these conversations, a lot of times the challenges of motherhood, balancing a conversation, balancing a job, and then being in power, and then having to navigate this space, I think it'll be informative for some of the conversations that we're going to have today. All right, Leader Booth, let me ask you a question. You know, I put on the paper, in our newfound relationship, we want to open up the phone lines at some point. Are you willing to talk to the peoples?
I am.
All right, y'all. I'm just telling you. Now, you know you don't get this too many places. Everybody call up and say, I'll talk, but I'm not going to talk to the people. No phones, right?
Right.
Well, I think what we got to take from this, and I know we got some tough conversations that we got to have, but I think what we got to take from this is, how do we start to push this ball forward? I think we know every single problem that exists, and we're going to talk about some of them, but I also want to utilize these opportunities to start to think about the people that are going to now be in new positions of power, looking at these conversations and these questions from a different perspective. So with that in mind, can we get into some headlines? We already made it to Peoria, because you know when you jump on the G12, and you hit Peoria, you be like, by the time you get up, you touching down in the Peoria airport. Now y'all know, last time I was in Peoria, Bolingbrook High School was down there for the state championships, and we lost to Simeon.
What was that in 1982?
excuse me, in case you have not paid attention, Bolingbrook today was, or yesterday was put in the paper as the 13th winningest team in the state of Illinois in the past decade. So
that's how you know people sports coverage is lacking, because somebody went through them records and calculated that, and I've been seeing news stories about that for the last 2 or 3 weeks. They know they could have put that in one article in a chart.
No, you got to stretch it out. You got to stretch it out.
We know we light on sports news, boy.
Well, I tell you what. Speaking of sports, you know, Leader, I gotta, you know, we gotta show some props. You know, besides Chicago, I guess Peoria is like the second city of basketball in Illinois. Like y'all, you know, we know y'all second city. I know y'all. What y'all got? Peoria Manual down there. Yes. Y'all got Peoria Central. Who else y'all got down there? Don't
Peoria
y'all got
Central,
a
Peoria Manual? Peoria, which was, but it's Peoria Manual all day. My husband was a coach at Peoria Manual for 10 years. So we rep Manual all day over here.
You know what? Mm. So that Peoria, you know, I got some guys, a lot of Sigmas came from Peoria. It was a Sigma breeding ground. And you know what? You got to go check out my man, Steve Winters, who has the barbershop.
Oh, come on, man. I've known Steve my whole life.
Look at that. Mm. See, you know what?
She said, don't do her.
She said, don't
do her.
Look.
That's her house.
Why?
Look, she said, don't do. She's like, I got the whole joint. She said, now I'm going to tell y'all, Leader Gordon runs Peoria. They like kind of like the first family down there. You know, it's like they like the Jay-Z and Beyonce. Can I tell y'all what? When Leader Gordon and I first started talking down in Springfield, you know what our common bond was? Jay-Z.
Like
we had a Hova quote for everything. Right. And we used to be like, we'll be like after session and somebody be at the Black Caucus house and we'll be like, you know, Jay say. Right. And it would always be some Jay-Z quote. So I'm looking forward to this conversation, because I think that for so long, these people, our elected officials, have been off somewhere that maybe have had the perception of not being accessible. And I am looking forward to making sure that you all see and understand what we got going for us as we move forward. All right, let's hit some of these headlines real quick. All right, first of all, second day of the Biden-Harris administration, second full day. Joe Biden yesterday signed 10 more executive orders.
Oh, boy.
Mostly COVID-related, right? 10, you know, the mask mandates on the airplanes, all of those good stuff. Ruthie, I think I know how you feel about it. Leader Gordon, tell me, how you feeling about the second full day, and what should black people expect? You know, I'm going to save that. How you feeling about the second day of that Biden-Harris administration?
I think it was, we could have pretty much choreographed what they were going to do just based upon some of the Trump policies that he had enacted via executive order. So there was no real surprise as of yet.
Okay.
So I'm looking forward to what's to come. Mm-hmm. And how specifically we can see ourselves in policies as well as executive orders that he signs in the future. I think one of the executive orders yesterday was the elimination of the 1776 commission.
Uh-huh. That too late, though. Too late. I'm just telling you, white people, the hillbillies done got their new history book. They are going to use that as their American history. You know how we used to have to carry that big old huge American history book to class? They gonna have that 45-page document that said slavery was good, we were supposed to do this. And I am concerned that in a low information age, even though we have access to Google, that the people that want to believe that 1776 commission will do so.
Well, I will say, I don't call them hillbillies.
Go ahead. What's up? Go ahead.
I don't use that frame.
Okay.
But I think that just the idea that this misinformation that he is intending to push, it's going to be incredibly important to for folks like us in state legislatures across the country, very much so akin to part of the policy that was in the education reform bill that was passed by the Black Caucus, requiring substantive Black history, because, you know, Rep. Ford has been working on that for a very long time, and that actually made it into the reform that was passed by Leader Ammons on last week. So I think it's, you know, that's a reality, but we also have the ability to counter that reality, particularly in our public school systems.
So I'm gonna tell you, I'm real nervous about this merger of immigration and blackness. You know, they've been trying to make us immigrants for a long time. And I'm just gonna put it out here, especially because you all are going to be in control of getting the school books or these schools around here. I'm concerned about with the Kamala Harris combined with this need to make slavery, to water down slavery and to create this immigration slavery narrative that then permeates into this Browning of America narrative, people of color. I just want to make sure that we don't get lost in the sauce there.
Yeah, there is far too much access to information, in my estimation, for that to ever be allowed to happen. And there are far too many strong voices elected to leadership at this point in our country's history for us to ever allow that to happen. Those of us who understand the painful history of slavery and the atonement that this country still has to make in regards to slavery in terms of descendants of slavery and the repairing of harm that needs to happen, we can't ever cede that ground in that conversation.
Okay. Well, you know what? We're going to save that because that's going to lead into our social media question of the day. Hey, y'all, did y'all see? Okay, I want y'all to be careful.
What?
Did you see Mayor Lightfoot is launching Chicago reunion? Okay, now I'm going to tell y'all, you know what that makes me nervous about? We already got a Chicago reunion weekend. It's called The Chosen Few.
Man, stop playing. Do you remember that house music festival or picnic they had downtown?
I told you about that.
But they've been taking it.
They've been plotting on it, but this might be the death knell. Because I don't see this is the difference. The difference is we had, you know, during this COVID thing, we done wiped out all of the old rules and all now has to happen is you ain't gotta get a chosen few a permit. Right? And that, like, before they had to ease into it. Coming back, they just going to be like, we call it.
You know, I think the chosen few is connected politically enough that they'll likely still get it.
Okay, I think for now. Mm-hmm. I think for now. But, you know, it's a changing world out here. I just I always get nervous when the white folks come up with the same idea we had. Why not just say chosen few? We doubling down on chosen few. If it's to bring Black Chicago back, don't reinvent the wheel. Don't be like Chicago Reunion Weekend. Don't be like they got to use their political connections. Work with the people that were already here. Now, I'm not the biggest house music fan. I really hate house music. But I do believe in what The Chosen Few does as it relates to being the international Black reunion for Black people from every high school, especially Bowling Brook. I just had to say that. Rep Gordon, do you know anything about The Chosen Few? I know you do.
Come on, man.
y'all drive up from Peoria. How long is the drive from Peoria to Chicago?
2.5 hours.
Oh, okay. So, yeah. So y'all know y'all kick it. I know y'all done came to The Chosen Few. I'm just going to tell y'all, when they start renaming and reinventing the same thing that we got in there and handed back to you, they selling your... Ruthie, you know they be talking about selling our culture back to us. Now, hey. You think about, they did the Black Christmas thing like that. They did Shop Black Chicago. Like, we ain't had Black Chicago, right. Shop Black Chicago
for years.
And then gave it to us from a white agency who said, we hired 2 Black people to get, they learned about it in the hood.
But okay, but this is different. This is Lightfoot plans reunion weekend to invite Blacks who fled Chicago back home.
That's who comes to The Chosen Few.
No, this is a different demographic.
Uh-huh. Yeah, okay. All right.
That's right. She's trying to repopulate the state again.
She's trying to show y'all Chicago is cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then she needs a better tailor.
It's nice here.
I'm just saying, if she want to show us she got... Did y'all... Okay. Did anybody see the picture, the meme that came out yesterday of Madam Vice President Kamala Harris, Michelle Obama, First Lady Michelle Obama, J-Lo, and then they put the mayor's picture right next to it?
Mm-mm.
And how they was all dressed and then...
Who got time?
Huh?
Who got time?
See, there you go, Ruthie. Always ruining the dang on joke. I'm just going to tell you. The mayor's going to do a lot. She going to do something with these carjackings.
That's what I'm saying.
If she wants somebody to talk about Chicago cool again, is Chicago safe again?
Right.
You act like she out there jacking folks.
She watching it. She acting like they ain't happening. Like, did y'all see David Brown yesterday?
It was so good to see David Brown.
No, every time you said we haven't seen him,
he be popping out.
Right, he be like,
the press conference right, the next day.
Right, he had a press conference.
They ask about you, David. Right.
Shout out to Martin, the crime chaser. I watched the whole press conference on Crime Chaser. I'll be like, bus channel 2579. Right. If Crime Chaser is there, we getting a real story. All right. Okay, the question of the day before we get to the social media question of the day. Ready? Keisha Cole or Ashanti? Who won the verses last night? Where on? Y'all go? Okay, y'all might be too young. Are y'all too young for this?
Maze, no. Stop playing with me.
You too young. You don't even know who Ashanti is.
Dude. Oh, my goodness. Oh, Murder, wow. Inc. I know Ashanti.
It's murder.
Come on, man.
All right, so let me ask the question. I'm going to be honest with y'all. I was sleep than a mug, but I woke up to Carrie had meme. Look, she had an iPhone, the other phone, and I don't know how she was putting up all the taking screenshots because she was screenshotting the whole joint. I woke up and, as you know, part of my morning routine, I take a small break in the morning and I, you know. But anyway, while I'm taking, I looked at Carrie's thing and I saw the whole thing. Sonya, do you know?
Remember when you walked out.
Okay, so who were you, Ashanti or Keisha Cole?
Ashanti, because she was bigger in my era.
Did Keisha Cole really Keisha even have an era?
She had that bustier. I don't know what's going on.
I'm going to just tell you.
And at that point, you know, I don't have my patience anymore.
Okay, so Ashanti, Sonya Escobar has Ashanti. Ruby Mo.
I'm team Keisha Cole.
I knew it. Because Keisha Cole is a hater.
No, I'm team Keisha.
It's something when you sing.
I think I'm more team Keisha just because she showed a lot more of her persona in some of the reality shows that she had. So I feel like I holistically know more about Keisha Cole.
But and I love mom is there.
And I love a good hood love song. And that's Keisha.
A good hood love song. Then you must have been Monica over Brandy too.
Not necessarily. Okay. That's a different era. Okay, that was still a little, you know, a little popcorn. R&B.
Okay.
But Keisha, yeah. Nah.
Okay, so you took Keisha. Okay, so Ashanti, Keisha, rep, let's do this.
You can't be leader. Half an hour late.
Leader. Hey, weigh in
what
on this
you,
one.
What say you, madam?
So what I was, say you?
I did not even know what was happening last night.
What?
She busy.
Where you
she
been? Busy. What you doing that
walking
you don't know
the
verses was happening? They've been waiting. They done broke it out 3-4 times. You probably just got confused.
I've been working.
Okay. Yes. Okay. But, I got you.
But Ashanti was my era in college, so okay. I would have to give it to Ashanti as it relates to a body of work. But I like what Ruthie said. In this era that we currently live in, we want to know our celebrities. We want to know them about their life. We want to know how they got to their place. We want to know their family, and we got all of that with Keisha and Ashanti. When she was going with Nelly, she kept that a secret. Like, it was just, Ashanti has a lot of secrets and mystery, but
that's her mother.
She has made a good body of music that I would have to connect to a little bit more. But Keisha does have that one banger with Missy, mm-hmm. and then that song, Love, that there is not a song that Ashanti has that can compete with either one of those songs.
Oh,
but as a large body of music, I would say that I would ride with Ashanti.
Dang.
That's fair. Great analysis.
That's fair.
Great analysis.
Yes. Well said, madam.
So, Keisha, to me, okay, so first of all, I didn't even know there was a Keisha Cole era. I just knew Keisha Cole had two songs.
What?
She had that Puffy song.
Huh. No, Keisha Heaven Cole got a body
and then
of work.
She had then that love, she that one is. With the love thing. Mm-hmm. So, I remember them two songs. And then I remember sprinkles of it. Right, but I didn't remember her. Like, it felt like Ashanti was always, every day, on the TV. You could not escape Ashanti. And that was probably when I was doing a lot more music promotion. I think when Keisha Cole came out, I was on to just, the only thing I was listening to was Jay-Z or I was reading a book. So I probably missed the whole Keisha Cole. And then when I turned on the TV and saw her mama was crackhead, I was kind of like, whoa, why are we doing this on TV?
Did you really just boil that down to that? There's a lot more to that.
I turned on the TV.
She's not just a crackhead. Right.
I got you. I mean that in the era before, I'm probably from the era before there was crackhead sensitivity to an extent. And I think that I've learned a lot more now, so I chill. But I think I came from an era when I saw the direct abuse of the explosion of the crack. And so she was just that to me, and I felt like it was like Flavor Flav.
From Cussie to someone with a disease.
It felt like Flavor of Love to me, where it's like, how can we show some more black dirty draws on TV?
You felt like BT exploited her family.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. And I think because there is empathy in our community, because we've experienced it, I think sometimes we think that we're laughing and they're laughing at us, as compared to us, like, kind of, that's something. And I get it. I just felt like we don't have to always show the worst of us. I'm a Cosby era kid. Now, I know Bill Cosby turned into whatever.
Okay, then. And that's an era, exactly.
Okay.
A problematic era.
Excuse me. I don't think the era was problematic. Bill Cosby, what he promoted wasn't bad.
Fake symbolism. Meanwhile, you drugging women. Mm-hmm. That's a problem. Mm-hmm. It's not okay.
Okay. Wait a minute. Y'all trying to, you saying Bill Cosby show is a bad thing for black people?
No, what I'm trying to say is the Cosby era, like that whole symbolism of what it represents, you have to still take into account him allegedly drugging. No, he went to jail. Him drugging and abusing those ladies, because I think it's all about imagery and symbolism, and we rebuff that because behind the scenes you're doing this, but you're telling the kids to pull up their pants.
I think it's fiction.
Just like reality TV. Reality TV, that's a show. That's for the check.
Heathcliff Huxtable, as Tennille said, is not in jail. Y'all not taking my Cosby. I don't care. Y'all cancel everybody y'all want to. I still want a Gordon Gartrell shirt. So I'm going to tell y'all that now. I ain't going nowhere.
What's that?
See? There you go. If you don't know about Gordon Gartrell, then we can't even have this conversation. All right, y'all. We gonna keep on moving. So who won, Keisha or Ashanti in this room? Leader, you did the whole political era. So who did you pick? Tell me which one.
If I didn't listen to the verses last night, but I'm gonna ride with Ashanti. She's a larger body of music.
Okay, so there you go. I'm gonna roll with Ashanti for her Instagram.
And she's a writer.
Okay. Yep.
Question. Did she do any of the songs that she wrote for J-Lo?
I don't know. I didn't watch it. Mm-hmm. Babe, did she? I'm watching. I asked Carrie. We'll find that out, leader. We'll find that out as we go. I'm going to run through a couple more of these headlines, then we're going to go to our social media question of the day. Okay. Leader Gordon, I'm going to push this. I'm going to point this out, and we're going to push this to the 7 o'clock hour. $31.4 million was distributed in grants from the R3 program.
Yes.
I know a bunch of that money was supposed to help us open up some black dispensaries. I'm going to save that for 7 o'clock because we are going to have a cannabis conversation. I'm looking forward to that. Shout out to Claudia Chavez. I worked with her on in the campaign that I finally got a date with Carrie on. She was Patrick Daly Thompson's campaign manager. I was helping on that campaign. She just became the liaison to the Department of Education, the White House liaison to the Department of Education. Just pretty cool to see people that you worked with, right, ascend. I just couldn't keep my mouth shut, right? I didn't know how to be quiet. But it is cool to see somebody you know working in the White House. And then did y'all see that the mayor closed the Mount? Did y'all know that in Mount Greenwood, typical Mount Greenwood, they had a bar that had a toast, a farewell toast, to Trump?
With like 100 people in there?
Uh-huh. 100 people inside the store. City shut them down.
Who told on them?
Now, you know it's always a snitch. It's always somebody trying to get some points. All right, y'all. Those are the headlines. You are tuned in to the Maze Jackson Show. Check us out on the What's In It for the Black People media page. You can also check us out on the Maze Jackson page. Y'all want to send us some stars, go on over to the Maze Jackson page. Bing, 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 bing. Help us keep on, keep the light on. Keep the lights on. Because the lights make it hot in here. You know what? I'm wondering what is going on with the heat, straight up. Now I done paid the bills, and that bad boy just don't want, I be waiting for the click. Now you come in here, it's like, no click. But it's hot in the mug in here.
No, it's not.
I'm going to put the heater by you. I got it. You know, we figured out we got a radiator. Oh, my God. We got an electric radiator in this bad boy. Hey, you know what? We got to call ComEd, get some light heap around this mug. That's what we got to do. All right, y'all. It's the Maze Jackson Show. It's time for the social. Can I get the,
It's time for the social media question of the day.
All right. Here goes the big voice. It is time for the social media question of the day. Ruth and Mo. Leader Booth, Sonia Escobar, we are in day two of the first 100 days of the Biden, the Biden-Harris administration.
That's right.
Now, I must tell you.
Pray tell.
That I told you I used to get a kick out of Donald Trump making white folks just pull their hair out because he was just so uncouth. Right, and it just made them feel like, dang, don't show up. Like, you know how y'all like
there's
Keisha
company,
Cole?
There's company.
I was like, Donald Trump showed they dirty jaws on TV every day, and I just loved it because they just used to get mad. Now, we are now moving into, and I remember when Ice Cube came out, and he was like, we need to have a contract with Black America. Both of y'all, we want to talk baddest man hit my hair. That did not come to fruition. And now, since that time, we have elected Joe Biden, the president, Kamala Harris, the first Black and South Asian vice president vice president. We have also delivered both Senate seats from Georgia to the administration, thus giving them all three chambers. They have the executive branch, the House, and the Senate. They do not have the Supreme Court. So let me not say all three branches, but they got the whole hill. Thus making it pretty difficult for the Republicans to defeat them on anything. Right. We see that Joe Biden is now pushing a $1.9 trillion COVID package that they are now negotiating. We know that Joe Biden is now signing executive orders. We have seen, in these last few years since Trump has been the president, we have seen governance through executive order, right? We have seen them be like, y'all ain't gonna do it. I just signed this piece of paper. Do it. What you mean we can't do it? Oh, yeah, we can do it. I'm gonna sign this piece of paper. Now, we see Biden unwinding all of those, but I was thinking about this first 100 days. Then I was thinking about the Obama era, and I was thinking about just us as Black folks, how we always seem to save America. So now I want to ask the social media question of the day, because I've been trying to figure out, how do we measure success of this Biden administration? And I keep coming back to this same question. They got the ability to do pretty much anything they want to do. If we don't get reparations, should we consider the Biden-Harris administration a failure for Black people? I mean, right now they're talking $1.9 trillion for America. When unemployment, my mentor talks often about unemployment. He says, Black people had 25% unemployment, and white America ain't even blink. White America hits 8% unemployment, and they start printing money. We know we were supposed to get ours. Now, I've been paying attention to all this stuff they've been talking about. They've been talking about Reconstruction, and I told y'all I was nervous we might still have a civil war. But I got to ask, reparations or bust, or were they a failure? I'm going to start with you, Ruthie Moore.
You asked a whole lot of questions.
Okay. Reparations are bust.
That's a loaded question.
Absolutely, reparations are bust. In the first 100 days.
Nah, that's not going to happen.
Okay, I was going to say, because my expectations are a little low for that happening. But
4 years.
But I will say that I never thought we would. Well, I knew he was going to see this day, but it was, I enjoyed hearing Biden say the words white supremacy. And I want to just pause for the memory of all the black people that done died for saying that, that have been killed or spiritually killed or financially killed for saying the words white supremacy. So that was nice in a sense. Now, do I think that that will impact reparations? Yes, because if you actually, the first step is to get white people to say it. And so now they've started saying it, because, you know, we've been saying it, right? So now that we got the highest, most powerful white man in the world to say the words white supremacy and the battle against white supremacy, we are in an absolute position to get reparations.
Okay, so I would almost agree with you with that.
Except you ain't got no hope.
Kinda. I got an inkling of hope, but it makes me nervous when Jim Clyburn, excuse me, Leader Clyburn, who literally picked two dead campaigns up, put both of those dead campaigns on his shoulders in South Carolina, gave them both mouth. Kamala was, excuse me, Vice President Harris was out of the race.
Out of there.
They were coming to brief us about the death knell of Joe Biden's campaign. I was sitting over at a place, and they was like, if this and this don't happen, we're toast. South Carolina happens, black people, and we are not, and both of them, neither one of them are even in consideration. And for him having all of that, two things he said made me nervous, especially in a political place. He said, I don't want nothing from Joe Biden. And then he came back with a national hymn. Now, I'm talking about, this got to be the most powerful black dude in Congress right now. And he want a hymn. I'm nervous. I'm nervous because, you know, we love symbolism.
And legacy. We like symbolism and legacy. Imagine being the black person that got lift every voice and sing.
Hold on, man. That's James Weldon Johnson. Don't trip, man.
I'm just saying, but that's like shout part of his legacy.
I got you. You see? Leader. The ball's in your court. Reparations are bust. How do we look at how can we judge this administration if we don't get reparations?
First of all, we need to decide, yes, we need reparations. That's, I think that's understood, but I want to put that on, be on the record with that.
Okay.
The next question I would say is, do we know what we want? Have we decided as a black delegation, here is the ask? Because when it comes to this political process, as long as the ball is able to be here, 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 and here, there's no real way to focus all of our attention and energy and direction on, hey, Mr. President, we delivered this for you and this is what we want. I mean, there has to be that level of clarity because we want something significant, right? We don't want anything ambiguous. We don't want symbolism. We want something that's real. So our ask needs to be real and tangible. And so my question is, do we have a tangible, specific ask?
So, you know, I've been thinking about this, and I was thinking that if we told the president that we want $1.5 million per black person, not per household, per black person, and I'm just telling y'all, I'm buying a Cadillac dealership the next day, but $1.5 million per person plus give us four states. Right? Give us four states that got a whole bunch. And we want, what did we say? We want a college education throughout perpetuity. Right? Black people don't got to pay for college. I mean, so how do we get to that? Because I guess, Leader, you have experience in this space. How do we get to a place where we make the ask? Because I do believe that reparations or bust, I don't think that with everything that we deliver, I don't think there's ever going to be a better time.
Agreed.
To go after it. Because white folks is feeling real guilty. Their kids is turning against them and turning them in on the no-fly list. No, I'm saying. You see people on the no-fly list, they be on TikTok like, that was my mom out there.
Right.
You need to. And so I think we have the leverage, but do we have the political will? And how do we put something like that together? How do you herd the cats to get there?
I mean, what you need is, you say it all the time, there has to be this connectivity between the streets, the community, the church, and politics. Everybody has a lane. Politics, the political arena, that's one particular lane. But once you get to the political arena, you have to know what you want, because you're going to be playing games with it. You don't know what you want. And if you want a specific ask, because we're talking about reparations, so we're not talking about symbolism. We're right. talking about big stuff here. And so if we're talking about that, people in Georgia, people in Florida, people in Michigan, people in Wisconsin, in Illinois, we should all be saying the same things. We should be applying pressure to not just the president, but there should be pressure applied to our congressmen and women that we elect, the senators that we're sending to DC. So the pressure has to be multiple levels, because the executive branch, where obviously President Biden is, that's just one level of government. We would also have to be able to put pressure on the congressmen and congresswomen and the senators that represent us as well. And so I would say our work begins with us and really unpacking what is it that we want, so that we can make that specific demand. And once we get to the place where we have our demand, I think we have a runway, because you're right. This is a moment that we're in. That, you know, we've all been saying this. We haven't changed. The world has changed in this moment after the murder of George Floyd. But these moments don't last forever. So we do need to capitalize on this moment and do need to take hold of the opportunity that's before us. But there's a lot of work that goes into that I don't see it done yet. But I could be wrong. Because there's an ADLS movement that's out there. I don't know where it is as it relates to a specific ask, but that would be my initial suggestion, is we need a tangible, specific ask that we all can get behind and apply pressure to.
Mm. Let me ask another question in that space. It seems to me like there's a move to marginalize the people that don't go along to get along, particularly in the black community. And so even in that space, so like, let's say the ADOS movement, right? And I'm going to just use that. It's like, we know that exists. And is it possible that the people that we have representing us are not in line with, and this isn't a diss, but it seems to me like, with everything that's going on, if the congressmen that are coming to the black community are telling us about kind of what they got, kind of a script that they have worked that works with the seniors all the time, and it's like, do we have the people in place capable of delivering the message of this time? Because quite frankly, they oftentimes are probably looking out the window, or they're not there. They're not in tune with the people. Like, I don't know if, again, who in South Carolina told Mr. Clyburn that the thing that we needed was a him? Where did that come from?
I don't know. I heard it for the first time this morning. I chuckled.
Okay. Look, you know what? I'm getting the sign. So, you know, we done changed up the format. So we got to, we're going to go to a break. Leader, we're going to give you a hot second to go do what you got to do. And in the meantime, we'll be back at 5 minutes after 7. But let me tell y'all real quick. Sissy's Taco Pop-Up Bar is back today and tomorrow, every Thursday and Friday in January. Stop by 312 East 75th Street and get authentic street tacos made with Southside soul. Now, Sissy's makes the best jerk chicken, sriracha. I like when they say sriracha. I can't wait for Todd to come back. Todd probably somewhere on the beach eating sriracha shrimp, right, while we talk about it, in a taco. Talk about it. He probably dripping it on. You know what? Let me stop. I'm going to leave. I don't even want that vision. Plus, they got blackened salmon and our vegan Cajun jackfruit tacos are becoming the talk of the town. Now, don't forget to ask about their Rome walking taco, sissy street corn, and the children's meal that comes with a special prize. Also, introducing tamales. And y'all know, I only had the boil in the bag tamales when I was a kid. And now I'm learning that there's really, like, really good tamales. But you got to pre-order them and sign up. And you can just go visit sissystacobar.com and sign up for the text message updates to get a free taco with any purchase. All right, and y'all make sure y'all stay safe. Keep your social distance, right? We got to protect Chicago in all that we are doing because this COVID is spreading. You're going to be hearing a lot more from What's in It for the Black People Media regarding protecting Chicago, the Protect Chicago campaign. So y'all stay tuned. We'll be back. It is the Maze Jackson Show. We got Ruthie Moore, leader Jahan Gordon Booth, President Pro Tempore, state representative. Plus, as she told me in my text messages, you know I'm a mama, right? All right, plus Sonia Escobar. Look, all of that will be right back.
The Maze Jackson Show. We'll be back after this break.
Hey, Chicago, it's Dawn Milhouse from the Book of Dawn. There's a lot of fake news about the COVID vaccine, just false information. So our station has joined the Protect Chicago team to help share the truth about the vaccine and dispel the rumors. I hear all the time, I've already had COVID. I don't need the vaccine. You're wrong. Get the facts by visiting the What's in It for the Black People Media page on Facebook and www.chicago.gov/COVIDVax. That's COVIDVAX. We're in this together, Chicago.
The Chicago Legal Network is the collaboration of attorneys that concentrate in many areas of the law most needed in Chicago neighborhoods. The CLN lawyers focus on personal injury, criminal defense, and other issues. The CLN lawyers all average over 20 years of legal experience and are dedicated to helping the Chicago community. The Chicago Legal Network is committed to developing black lawyers through mentorship and co-representation. So if you were injured in a car accident, slip and fall, or injured on the job, or you need assistance with criminal defense, including driving violations and DUI, check out ChicagoLegalNetwork.com for more information or call 773-912-3545. 773-912-3545.
Tune in every Sunday. Don't miss it. Live from the West Center for the Black People Media Studios, it is the Kickoff Kickback. Join the conversation with the brothers, Eugene McIntosh, Herb Howard, and myself, Terrence Tomlin.
We got analysis live from the stadium. The brother Joe Lewis will be following through. We got great guests coming in, players, personnel, people.
Say what?
We do our thing every Sunday from 10 a.m. to 12 noon, taking you right up to kickoff.
We're picking the full slate of NFL games. We're talking fantasy football. Gino got you covered on all the bets. It's a kickback.
Make sure y'all join the conversation. Smash that like button. Smash that share button. And continue to help us push the culture forward.
Don't miss it every Sunday from 10 a.m. to 12 noon, live here from the West Center for the Black People Media Studios.
Shop at Black-owned and operated Solo Beauty, where you are appreciated and respected. Located at 8158 South Cottage Grove, Solo Beauty can supply all of your black hair care needs. Solo Beauty is open from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. Tuesday through Saturday.
Blame it on the alcohol, baby. Blame it on the alcohol, baby. Blame it on the alcohol.
driving this too. That's a big deal. It's like that's a threshold to cross.
Listening to the most dangerous show in the morning. This is What's in It for the Black People Radio. Maes Jackson. Maes Jackson, the most vociferous advocate for black people in the world.
We need money and no symbolism. It's Maes, it's Sonya, and Ruthie and Ty explaining how we all come from God.
We're about to be back on air in a minute. Why?
United, our movement gonna stop. If they ain't trying to help us, they ain't trying to do nothing. We gotta do something, we gotta stop running. It's time to confront the problem. Really, you expect your oppressed to solve them.
Wake up, Chicago. Wake up, world. This is the Maes Jackson Show. I'm your host, Maes Jackson. Got my co-host, Miss Ruthie Moore. Well, I sounded like Tommy from Who Annoyed.
You did.
Ruthie Moore.
Baby, baby, boom, back ribs.
I need the baby, 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 back ribs. Moo Annoyed. You know, man, these are days you need Moo Annoyed back. We could have.
No. After you told me that it was not black owned, that blew my mind.
You did not know?
I just knew Moo Annoyed was black owned.
You know. Can I tell you that...
Just like Daly's.
You thought Daly's was black owned?
I mean, that was a whole bunch of black people working
in
up
Chicago,
in there.
So let me tell you, that Moo Annoyed was probably the most marketing genius. That, you know what, though? They were no different than Chess Records. No, seriously. When you think about the people that recognize the value in... the identification with black culture and black lifestyle, you think about what Moo Annoyed meant, and they knew to stay out the way and collect the money. And so you let Tommy be Moo Annoyed, but you know the dude on the commercial, it's just like the dude on Empire. 5, 8, 8, 2, 3. He ain't making the money.
Empire. Ooh.
Right? Okay. You know what I'm saying? But what they were smart enough to do was to recognize the need for, what you mean? Babe, you mean... My wife is saying right now, she didn't know that Moo Annoyed wasn't black owned. Y'all, who did not know that Moo Annoyed wasn't black owned?
I didn't know till you told me.
You know where I learned that? I learned when I was working at V103, right? And Tommy would actually come make appearances, and he was like and I probably was thinking the same thing until one day I got sent over to Moo Annoyed to go pick up the check. And it was not Tommy who was writing the check. Right? Same guys own furniture stores in our community. It was like our neighborhoods have never really been owned by us a lot. And then people, when that community moved out, they sold it to another community, right? And then another community took advantage as well. All right, look, I done went way down the path. Look, y'all, this is the Maes Jackson Show. Maes Jackson, Ruthie Moore, Sonya Escobar, and y'all know we broadcasting from Peoria. We took the G12 down to Peoria. We sitting on the pad in the G12, on the G12, because we had to meet up with the new El Presidente, no, Aya Presidente, pro tempore, or pro tem, excuse me, leader, as well as State Representative Jahan Gordon Booth. She is from Peoria. You know what, leader, we did not do a lot of background on you before we came on the show this morning, because we was going to spend a little time with you today at this 7 o'clock hour. So why don't we go backwards a little bit? And why don't you tell us a little bit about who you are, personally and professionally, and tell us a little bit about your district, because you're not, you're one of the few black legislators that's not actually from Chicago. Talk to me.
Sure. I was actually born and raised in Peoria. One of the other things that you and I have in common is we both went to the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign.
ILL. I.
And I'm, you know what? I'm like a lot of other women, right? Like, I'm a wife, I'm a mom. As a matter of fact, if you just saw me waving, my son is driving to school for the first time today. He got his license this summer, and we've been a little on edge. And so I'm sharing this because I have like goosebumps all over me. I wanted to go out and take a picture, but I'm with you guys instead.
Oh, that's that political cost, man. It's a price to these politics. We're going to talk about that too.
So, but Peoria is like a lot of communities, right? Peoria had a, like a lot of other towns, was heavy as it relates to manufacturing. And about 5-6 years ago, Caterpillar, which was headquartered here, picked up and moved and relocated to Deerfield, Illinois, near you all. And so, like a lot of other communities around the country, Peoria is going through a transition period right now where we're trying to re-identify who we are, because we had always been a heavy manufacturing town for a long time, and now we've moved into healthcare. But like a lot of other communities, Peoria has a lot of issues as it relates to inequities that folks like myself and other folks that are rooted in this community are trying to push back against. As a matter of fact, we currently have a mayoral campaign going on right now. My longtime mentor is running for mayor. She is a dope African-American woman by the name of Dr. Rita Ali. If you ask me, I think she's the front runner, not for emotional reasons, but politically, I think that she has what it takes to not only win the race, but to move this community forward. And so when you ask me about who I am and how I show up to this space, all of us are, we bring the experiences that we have to the jobs that we currently are in. And so my experience of being a woman that grew up, was born and raised in Central Illinois. Oftentimes when I listen to this show, I identify with a lot of your stories from Bolingbrook. Many of the things that you experienced going to Bolingbrook High School were very much so like the experiences that I had, but I also connect very much so with many of the farm stories that Ruthie shares about growing up and being at one with nature, but also being very much so connected to my history, connected to my roots, connected to my people. My mother started the Urban League in this community at this point, 50 years ago. As you know, my mother passed away some time ago, but you know, all of that, right, informs how I show up here. I don't come from a community that's majority Black. So when I was making the comment about when we were in the previous segment, we were talking about reparations, and I was saying, you know, we need to make sure that we all are on the same page so we can press on our congressional members. And when I was thinking about congressional members, I wasn't just thinking about, you know, Robin Kelly, Danny Davis, Bobby Rush. I was thinking about folks like Sherry Bustos, right, who was my congresswoman. Some of these other congresspeople who get elected because we support them, but don't necessarily know what our issues are. And so I show up to this space as someone who is very much so connected to who I am and who I serve, but also knowing that the world, although we are a large caucus and a powerful caucus, as the Black caucus, we are not the majority caucus, because the majority caucus is white. And so that's how we're showing up, but we're also leveraging our power is always going to be our unity as Black folks, period. Right? We don't, as a people, we're not incredibly organized right now. We don't have all the money, but what we do have is we have our collective interests. and the ability to remain unified. There would be no Speaker Welch if you would have had dissension within the Illinois Legislative Black Caucus. It just simply would not have happened.
Hold it, because you're getting ahead of me. I'm going to get to that. I want to go slow in some of these parts, and then there's other parts that I think we got to break down. So when we got into this, we talked about, I listed, so we now have a new black speaker, Speaker of the House, Chris Welch, who, while black, does have the responsibility of holding a caucus majority, which is going to be black, white, Asian, Latino, and all of those different things. So he's got a challenge there, and we know that one of the things that happens when we get the top black spot, then a lot of times when you get the top black spot, then you get convinced, or you have to placate because the white folks don't have a same sense of loyalty. I need to help our audience understand the perspective of what happened in Springfield, and I'm going to go from a leadership perspective, then we'll talk about policy, and then we're going to get into the cannabis conversation. But I need for people to understand what exactly happened in this, because yesterday Speaker Welch also rolled out his leadership team. What is that? What does it mean? And what does your position in it mean? Because they created, quite frankly, a spot that kind of inserted you already in the hierarchy, but another spot as well. So help us understand what you do now in this spot, and what does that mean for black people specifically?
So the spot of Speaker Pro Tem, the Senate actually has always operated with a President Pro Tem. So when you were saying President Pro Tem, I knew that was what you were leaning to, because the Senate has always used that position. Under this former Speaker Madigan, there was no Speaker Pro Tem.
Of course.
So moving forward in a new direction with new leadership, Speaker Welch decided to create the position of Speaker Pro Tem and offered me that spot based on, you know, my collective body of work, how I show up, et cetera. And so I was, without question, I was honored to be given that opportunity to serve in this capacity. I've been in leadership for a few years. And so to be able to support his leadership, it is a very exciting time. I know that I've never been more excited or gratified to see us come together as a people and be able to do what many thought was unthinkable, right? The Senate Black Caucus, they've had these elections a lot more often than we have as a House.
Clearly.
First in 40 years, right? And to come out on the other side with an African-American speaker, I think is tremendous. And it's not just tremendous that we made an African-American speaker, but that was just literally the cherry on top for an incredibly aggressive week that literally only was called because the Black Caucus said, we have work to do and we're coming down here to work on our agenda. That's it.
So let me stop you right there. Because there was some internal debate regarding the speaker and the Black Caucus. I think that it was widely assumed that the moment that the Black Caucus decided to weigh in, that they were going to be the ultimate kingmakers. But it always, and I think this is what I am so ecstatic about, was that there are the usual divisionary tactics that white folks can employ to break us up. And one of the things that I saw happening, and I'm going to spill some tea here, so I'm sorry, but one of the things that we knew was happening behind the scenes was, as Speaker Welch, as the Black Caucus was trying to make a decision, we saw white folks trying to cause dissension in a variety of different ways, one of which is which they tried to pit you, per se, against Speaker Welch in the space. And I'm just tell y'all, at that time, still leader and Representative Gordon was like, I'm not going. We're going to help this black man get over the top, and I will not be part of the division. Talk to me about really what kind of inspired you to get behind Speaker Welch, knowing that you probably could have gotten the Woke White Women's Caucus to jump on board and kind of drive that space in between. Tell me how you kind of navigated that, and what was your motivation when you were clearly like you wanted to see this brother make history?
So I think that, you know, some of the things that happened this summer, conversations certainly picked up in regards to potentially the end of the Madigan era, right? And, you know, folks continued to have conversations all summer about who could it be, who could put together 60. Those conversations have been bantered about a lot. And so anyone who was considered as someone that could put together 60 is someone who a lot of people began to, you know, text, call, et cetera. And so I think of any number of us that sort of fit into that category had to go inward and ask ourselves, is this the thing that we wanted to do next? And I'm sure Chris, I know Chris was getting calls this summer, just like I was getting calls this summer. And, you know, I thought about, is this what I want to do? Is this where I want to go? And at this point in my life, and as I shared with you earlier, I have, I'm a mother, I'm a wife, I have children, I am an incredibly hands-on mom. And I,
yes, we see. We see you all over the mom squad.
Into my daughter's business, but my daughter has had some health challenges as of late. And so what I know from just having served in leadership is the time commitment that is required for this position. A lot of people get caught up on titles, position, perceived power, but I don't think people realize the amount of sacrifices that people must make in order to be able to maintain that level of power. And so I just went into myself first and foremost to say, is this what I want to do? And at this moment in my life, it isn't what I want to do. And so when I said, okay, boom, I don't want to do it, the next question for me then became, who can do it? And without question, that person was Speaker Emmanuel Chris Welch. Chris Welch did not just become a leader when he was elected speaker last Wednesday. Number one, and so this is for me personally, I look at not just people's politics, I look at the man, the woman. And to me, Chris has been a great husband. I've seen him be an incredible father to his children. That someone else may not care about that, I do. I've seen Chris show up in a leadership capacity at times of great strain. So if you remember, during the Rauner era, there was a time in which the legislative salaries were cut off for almost a year. Speaker Welch, then Representative Welch, was plaintiff to that suit. A lot of people wanted him to do that, including Republicans. But was anyone else willing to be the plaintiff and put their name on the line in order to help the entire caucus? No, they were not. I've seen Speaker Welch take on any number of issues, focusing specifically on African-American issues, whether it be taking on the NCAA, whether it be taking on immigration issues at times when maybe Black folks didn't want him taking up on immigration issues. But the fact of the matter of it is, we don't do big things alone. And I know you're not the strongest proponent of the sort of Black and Brown coalition. I get it. But I can tell you that had it not been for the Black Caucus and the Latinx Caucus, we might not be in the position to have been able to make the speaker. And so, you know, we just always have to be cognizant about our interests. And I think that he's just been an incredibly smart, hardworking, honest, deliberate man the entire time that I've known him. And I've known Chris now for about 8 or 9 years. And I've just known him to be an incredible person. So I had no problem doing everything that I could to ensure that this person that I believe in, that I've seen get out here and take stones and arrows.
I shot some of them. I threw some.
I know you throw them at him, you throw them at me, but we still here.
Right.
Right. We have things that we can accomplish together, right? Us in our position, you in your role, like we can do this. And I believe that. And I think that you believe that now too. and seeing us come together and be unified around this issue. And this is the first of many. It's a new day in Springfield. And Ruthie has had our back, because I listen to y'all every day. Ruthie's had our back for a little while, because when you was shanking us here and there, Ruthie would say, hold on now, hold on. They gonna do it.
Well, let me say this, and I want to...
You didn't have enough faith in us, but Ruthie did, so thank you, Ruthie. Thank you for having faith
in us. You already know. Look,
Ruthie going to be down there with y'all at some point in her life. but let me tell you, leader, and I'm going to tell you I appreciate that, and I got to tell y'all some behind the scenes. So, like, in the mix of what was happening to Speaker Welch, as there was the machinations behind the scenes, I'm not going to elaborate too much except to say that there were, and I'm going to do this talking so you can sit out. You don't even got to comment on this. But there were a lot of woke white women who were attempting to use every trick and tactic in the book, including inserting Leader Gordon into conversations that would potentially be divisive without necessarily her knowledge. Let me just tell you, I was like, hey! This was happening, and she was like, hold up, who was it, and tell me what's up, because I'm up on them right now. We finna clear it up. And Leader Gordon did not hesitate to check. You know how they be like, who gonna check me, boo?
Mm-hmm.
She rolled up and was like, that would be me. I'm going to be checking you. And so I'm gonna let it be. But just know that when there were times to, when the brother was under attack and under assault, and you know I'm always talking about when brothers and sisters don't get each other's back, and you know I've also been very, the sister got behind, not only got behind the back, but when we had the who gonna check me boo moment, boo got checked and then some. And we now have a black speaker, which I gotta now go, Leader Gordon, to where I have jabbed you and the Black Caucus numerous times. And I feel like just because we are going to figure out a way forward, I got to talk a little bit about what has happened in the past. Leader Gordon, it is no secret that anytime I have seen you involved in something, I have taken a position of I believe in her, right? I trust her, right? And I don't trust a lot of people down in Springfield, and in the times when times were much different, we always had a line of communication. And so I trusted you on cannabis. I trusted you. I remember the first time that the two white ladies called in on the radio and was telling us about the legalization of cannabis and why it was important. I was like, why do I have two white women calling in to the blackest station in the country telling me about what criminal justice reform? And I was very adamant, like, don't come back to me talking about this unless y'all got some sisters involved. I mean, some black people involved, because we were penalized. We suffered from it. And one of the things I often also talk about is we get out of jail and white people get rich. And in this case, re-rich. I remember talking to the gentleman at GTI, Green Thumb, who are now very heavyweight down in Springfield. And they told us before this happened that this was Prohibition 2.0. They had just sold Jim Beam for $17.9 billion because they wanted to enter into this cannabis industry. The industry then is made legal. I remember the first time we was talking about cannabis when it was medical. And I remember sitting through it and watching the white guys put every stigma on it to make sure that we didn't get a piece. And then we came back to make it legal, and I remember seeing JB and it being a big old part of it, and I still was like, I don't know who I trust. And then we saw you, and we saw Toy. And I'm going to tell you that Toy and I go all the way, excuse me, at that time, Senator Hutchinson, go all the way back to protesting on the president's lawn at University of Illinois. So there are no two legislators that I wanted to see be more successful in delivering this. But some kind of way, we wound up with none, like zero, no black ownership. And the program that was created, the social equity program, literally became a ripe with, if you look at this JB Corruption website, it's pretty scary to see that we got like nothing and white folks, as we talk about equity, got re-rich. How did that happen, leader? And how are we going to get this thing right? Because it's surpassing cannabis now. I mean, it's surpassing alcohol with tax revenue. Then we just saw this R3 program where they gave out $31.4 million, in my estimation, in a rush to get it out because we black folks ain't getting nothing. Talk to me about this and talk to me about this situation.
So there's a couple questions that were asked. So let me just try to unpack this piece by piece.
Go ahead.
First of all, the question was, how did we get here? I think, so let's take a step let's take a step back for a moment and let's rewind to 2019. We began working on this bill in 2016, but that was under the Rauner era, and clearly there was not going to be any cannabis legalization that was going to happen under Bruce Rauner's administration. But when JB, when Governor Pritzker and Lieutenant Governor Stratton won the very next day, after they won their election, that was like the tee off, right? That they wanted to work to legalize cannabis. And so soon thereafter, we began the negotiation process down in Springfield. And as you know, because I reached out to you, I'm like, look, I think we have something. And Toy and myself, we reached out to you. We were sort of walking through to you what we had built out, because there was no model in the country. So there's no other state in the country that's done this. So there wasn't a pathway to say, okay, here's how you make sure black folks are in the industry, because there aren't black folks in a whole lot of industries, as you eloquently articulate on here all the time. So what we wanted to do was create a pathway so that we could create black millionaires in this new industry. And there was a lot of excitement around the policy that we passed in Springfield. And what you know, that I know, that Ruthie knows, that a lot of folks know, but everybody doesn't know, is the fact of the matter of it is, as a legislator, your job is to legislate. Once you pass that law, that bill has to be implemented. Okay? That bill then has to be implemented. And as a legislator, you are not a part of that implementation process. So just like you imagine, you know how you feel about where this is right now. Imagine Toy, imagine myself, who was so incredibly involved in this space for years and came into this space with one objective and one objective alone. And that was to make sure that black people were made whole through economics, by having ownership in the space, so that folks that had been harmed had those harms repaired as it relates to expungements. I know that you don't really care for the expungement space.
Oh, I do. I care about it. I just want some money to go with it.
And I'm with you. I'm with all that. That's why it's in the bill. Because I want black folks to get rich. I want people who have been shut out of the economy because of convictions to have the ability to have that conviction off their record. And I want money going back into black communities, which is R3. So it was always scheduled for R3 to roll out every year. So the fact that the money rolled out yesterday, that isn't, actually it's a little bit behind schedule, to be honest, because we thought that money was going to be rolling out in September, November. But the reality of it is COVID, just in the way that you all operate, COVID has changed everything, and it slowed up the rollout of the R3 money, as well as there was a leadership change over at R3. There's now there's a sister over there now. We had Sharice Williams, who was the interim director for some time, who was a phenomenal, phenomenal transition. And then now there's a new director over there named Del Reese Adams. I think she comes from the county, but it's the first time that they've had black leadership over there at ICJ. We'll put that on the shelf for a moment, and we'll come back to the licensing, because that is what is most controversial, and that is what is most concerning for all of us. if you think about where we find ourselves in this moment in having no black operators, there are no black operators right now because there were no black folks in medical. The black folks that were in medical, because there were a couple black folks in medical, they sold their interest in their businesses. when the licenses were, excuse me, not the licenses, when the scores were announced on September 3rd, one of the things that you may or may not know is that the first letter that went out on September 4th, I'll never forget, it was Beyonce's birthday. I woke up and I was beside myself. Like you, like the Black caucus, like the Latino caucus, like the Progressive caucus, there was no caucus that felt like what we had just passed, what we had poured our hearts into, that was not reflected by what was announced. In no way, shape, form, or fashion had that been reflected. And so that morning, it was a Friday morning, I put pen to paper and then sent that letter out to the larger Black caucus. The Black caucus then signed on to, that the Latino caucus then signed on to, that the Progressive caucus then signed on to, telling Governor Pritzker to stop the lottery. To stop the lottery, because we did not, number one, we didn't feel like there was enough information at that time for us to even be able to weigh in, because everything was coming out so quickly. There were, the majority of the information, as you will remember, was really coming out through the media. But we asked him to stop that lottery until we can get a stronger footing as it related to who was in that 21 of the 75, because that was never the intention of the policy. So as you know, the lottery still has not moved forward. There are Black folks in that lottery who want that lottery to move forward. But what we have said as a caucus and as a body and as a as someone who has spent a lot of time on this issue is that we cannot have the taint and the stain of what rolled out to be the measure by which we want this judged by.
So back so up. Let me back up. Let me stop you right there. You say taint and stain. So you agree that the process is flawed at this point. Where did the breakdown come? Where did the breakdown? It seems like there were so many safeguards that were put in place. And then when I look at this JB Corruption website, it seems like it seems like everything that I talk about all the time. The white folks looked at this social equity camp, this social equity program, figured out how they can manipulate it. And then, because we're not oftentimes, we wanted to help Black people, but because we couldn't say Black people, then we came up with this name, social equity candidates, that allowed the white people that gentrified our neighborhoods to come and take advantage of it. Where is the governor's office in this? Like, where is their sense of justice and equity? I saw the governor coming around waving his fist when George Floyd died. At the same time, I feel like that fist was full of rich white people's money from the cannabis. Where did this breakdown come, and how do we get at it, and how do we work together to fix this? Because I'm telling you, it's like, and when I was watching negotiations, full disclosure, Representative Leader Booth at the time was pretty adamant, even in the Springfield, this last go round, that if we didn't get some equity, some agreement between the Black people that were fighting and that were fighting to be included and the current operators, that there would be no bill, because the white folks was looking to take advantage of that bill and create an opportunity for other white people to come on in without making sure that we get it whole. Leader, how do we get this right, man?
What I would say is, easily we can go back and we can look at some of the scoring irregularities that transpired as it related to some of the application process. Many of us were, as legislators, were unaware of KPMG's involvement. The reality of it is their involvement began to put some really constrained relationships around what this process was, what it looked like, our intentions in passing the bill. Again, which is why we, as the Black caucus, I put pen to paper, we were the first caucus to say, no, Governor, you have to stop this lottery. You cannot continue in this direction until we find a path to right this ship. And so that's the work that's being undertaken right now. I love what you said in regards to how do we move forward? And you can't move forward without looking back to see what went wrong. Where did things go off the road, and how do we repair that moving forward? And what I would say to the governor's office is that they have been a willing partner to work with the Black caucus and the Latino caucus to fix this, because this is a part of all of our legacy, all of us that are Black, all of us that are woke, all of us that want to see all of the fanfare, right? After we passed this policy, there was such excitement around making sure that Black people and other people of color had the opportunity to play in this space. That has to come to fruition. And until that comes to fruition, this will never be viewed as a success. Never. And I think we're all acutely aware of that. And my continued involvement in wanting to clean this up has solely been around that one issue, is wanting to see Black folks win. That's it. It's wanting to see us win.
Let me ask now, with the shift in power, the shift in leadership, one of the things that I noticed was that as I've been watching this thing happen is that there really were no, well, let me take that back. There were some Black lobbyists, but I think Black lobbyists oftentimes are happy to just be able to get a contract, right? To be able just to even be in it. But what I did not see was advocacy. Let me back up. I question who and how the people that became that were the advocates for Black people in this space became really the only people that won. They came on the show and they kind of explained how we were all kind of slow and mm-hmm. didn't understand that we needed to have a veteran in the process that made it $1 million deal. And I guess my question is, how do we make sure that the advocates that we're working with in this space now have the best interests of the greater good as compared to the individuals? Because I guess if you send me to go get trained to someone and then everybody that they train fails, but they wind up getting licenses or are in the lottery, I guess my question is, how do we decide who are the advocates for Black people, and how do you all distinguish that in going forward mm-hmm. in this space?
So that's a great question, because here's the reality, Maze. There are a lot of interests in this space. I'm gonna give you an example. We did not like the result of the scoring, and we were very uncomfortable with the irregularities. So we asked the governor to stop the lottery, which he did. And then there was the discussion around moving forward with a second lottery. to let out even more licenses, and then taking some of the mistakes that we saw happen in potentially the folks that were in the 1A lottery, and then cleaning up for those mistakes before the 1A lottery was let. Here's what you have. We have a space now, Maze, where you got Black folks that are in 1A that don't want to see certain things happen in 1B because they have a separate interest. All Black people are not coming into this space at the same pace. You have some Black folks who have probably filed a lot of applications. That's the reality. You have some Black folks who maybe only put together one or two applications. So for example, if you have, let's say we have a conversation around caps, right? Capping the amount of dispensaries that one organization can get. If you're someone, if you're a Black applicant, that flooded, right? If you flooded your entries, you don't want to see a cap. Think about that, because that's against your particular interest. You don't want to see that cap. But if you're someone, if you're a Black applicant and you did all that you could to put together one to two applications, you think that cap is fair. Now, the reality of it is that we have a scenario right now where there are lots of competing interests, but what has to be done is what is going to be in the greater interest of ensuring that we have Black people as owners and operators in this space. And so a few weeks ago, you had a woman on here by the name of Natasha. Mm-hmm. I believe it was New Year's Eve yep. that she was on your show. I reached out to you. I said, hey, I wanna connect with her. She seems incredibly knowledgeable. I wanna tap into what she's feeling, what she's experiencing, what she's hearing, because again, I'm a legislator. I'm not in the cannabis space as an entrepreneur. So I want to talk to the Black folks that are on the ground every day in this work because I want their perspective to inform how I'm showing up in rooms as it relates to advocacy for Black folks being in this space. And Natasha and I have been communicating significantly since you connected us on New Year's Eve. And so she and I, we were texting a lot back and forth during the lame duck session when there was potentially an opportunity to get a bill through. But as you stated earlier, when the decision was made to begin to throw in some of the issues that killed the bill before, that slowed it down. But I do, I said all that, but I want to say this. I feel very good about the potential to move this conversation forward in a way that ensures that we're bringing Black folks into this space. Myself, leader Napoleon Harris, leader Lightford, and Chairman Ford, we're all working to ensure that these conversations are being moved forward and that we're pulling these organizations and these groups along the way, that they have a voice at the table, that as these conversations move forward, we're taking into account the input of what they are experiencing and what they're feeling. Because to your point, how do you know which group to listen to? You have to listen to everybody. And then the process has to be transparent and it has to be informative. Because the reality of it is that we may be on, you may have different groups that have very different interests, but they're all Black. And to me, what our interests as Black legislators must be is what is the policy that is going to have the most impact on ensuring that we get as many Black business owners in this space. That has to be our North Star.
Let me ask you this, Leader, with some of the legislation that you passed, particularly in the economic package of the omnibus, we talk about descendants of American slavery in that and utilizing that as a factor. One of the things that we've heard time and time again from Governor Pritzker, from everybody, is we'll get sued if we try and use these rules. It seemed like when the Black Caucus faced that challenge this last time, they were like, well, sue us then. Can we get that language inserted in this bill, and can we identify the people that are in opposition to it? And then, you know, we kind of work in collaboration to eliminate their opposition. Like, what can we do to punish or to prevent? Like, I guess my thing is the white guys that keep writing the rules to exclude us because we're not in the lobbying space a lot of times, and I'll talk about that on a different note. Can we now start to leverage this newfound Blackness to inject Black into this cannabis discussion?
So what I would say is, first and foremost, we have to be mindful of is what we're trying to correct for. And really what we're trying to correct for is, in some ways, we're trying to correct for anti-Blackness, but we're also trying to correct for capitalism, because that is what we are. That's what we are up against, right? These aren't just regular folks that are getting into this industry. As you stated before, these are people with big pockets. And you know, when people have big pockets, how do they hurt you? They hurt your money and they keep you tied up in litigation. So what we wanna make sure that we do is we wanna make sure that this was like the camel's nose under the tent, right? That specific language in that bill that we passed, because we wanna see how far we can go with that language. Because to your point, we're always told that, you know, if we use this language, it's unconstitutional. We can't go in that direction. If we go in that direction, we could be potentially hurting and harming the very people who we are trying to hurt. That is an attempt to see how far we can actually get with that language. Because what we don't want to do is we don't want to find ourselves. I don't think that we can be so afraid of litigation that we don't do what we know that we need, that we believe that we should do. But at the same time, what we also have to be mindful of is that we don't want an injunction, right? If we have an injunction, you know what happens? Nothing moves forward. We don't have any Black people in the industry. And the only people that will continue to make money are the people who made money last year. And they don't look like any of us, right? And so whose interests are served if there's an injunction that's moved forward? It's not yours, it's not Ruthie's, it's not, and here, I don't have an interest in the cannabis space personally, other than to professionally want to have played my own little part in seeing this industry flourish with Black people in ownership positions. And so the question that you ask is, how do we do this? We're trying, right? If we look around and we see what other states are doing, nobody's doing this. We're trying to do some things that no one else has done in this country. No one else has done in the state of Illinois. It's not happening at the county level. It's not happening at the city level. We're trying to do things that other folks simply have not done. And so what we need is we want folks to work with us. We're putting it on the line. We're trying to push against the envelope to see how far we can go as it relates to directing opportunities and resources to people who have been marginalized for generations.
Let me stop you right there, Ruthie.
Representative Booth, I have a question for you. So you said a couple of times, I have no interest in the cannabis sort of industry. And so can you talk a little bit about how white politicians and elected officials can easily transition into the economic and benefit from the business and the capital firm side? But it seems like Black elected officials have a harder time doing things like having a property tax company and still passing legislation. So can you talk a little bit about how kind of culturally conflicts of interest prevent economic development, blah, 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 blah?
So I would say that historically, and Mays talks about this quite a bit, in that you oftentimes find that Black legislators don't move into these spaces that they operate in post their time in office. And so some may view that as a detriment, but personally, I do think that it's positive from the standpoint of having clean hands. One of the reasons why I am very comfortable operating in this space. So going back over a year ago after the policy passed, you would find I was getting a lot of phone calls from folks that wanted to be in the space. And one of the things that I would always be very specific in telling people is that, listen, I am not a cannabis organization. I think that you should talk to the very people who do that kind of work, because I have a specific lane and my lane is policy. And I want to stay in that lane, because what became very clear to me is that this was a massive industry and I didn't want the taint of being involved on the business side of things, because once that happens, you can easily be discarded as someone who was operating for a separate interest. And I never wanted to be aligned with any specific business interest. And my interest is, I've always made my interest incredibly clear. And that was in making sure that Black people have the ability to get in this space and become millionaires and create generational wealth for themselves and their families, irregardless of who that is. So as it relates to other communities, it's the fact that we live in America, why white people have the ability and opportunity to do things that Black people, and in this regard, Black legislators, don't do. So one of the things, though, that in looking at the R3 program, if trying to connect this conversation to the larger conversation about the $31 million that was rolled out yesterday, specifically around economic development, the R3 program, the Reinvest, Restore, Renew program, was actually a part of the policy that we passed in 2019. And what we were looking to do was we were looking to ensure that, again, we wanted black people to be in the ownership space. We wanted Black folks to have the ability to have their records cleared, but we also wanted investments in Black communities around issues that Black communities have. And so the five key areas that R3, and I got my little phone, so I don't mess anything
That's
up.
Okay.
The five, and I don't have my papers, mate. I heard
Look, that's what I'm talking about. She said, I got my papers. All right, we got you. You've been going solo dolo. We'll let you take your 5 points off your paper.
I got five key little, look, where's
the camera at? Hold up. Move it over to the right.
So, youth development, violence prevention, reentry services, legal aid, and economic development. So those are the five areas that people have the ability to go after this R3 money for. Those areas are specific so that we can begin to chart right? How these investments are being made and how our communities are being positively impacted by the reinvestment of these cannabis dollars. And it's 25% of this cannabis revenues that are going back into our communities. And so the economic development piece is a key, because one of the statements that you made earlier, Mays, was about having the ability to allow people to come into the space to help other people to get into the industry. And you can do that under the R3 grant initiative in the economic development space.
But right? Leader, I'm with you on that, except for, and I thought a big chunk of that R3 money was supposed to help people who wanted to build dispensaries or who wanted to
build
businesses.
But who said that, though, Mays?
Huh?
Who said that?
That is not supposed to help people that do the...
it's not just that, though.
I didn't think it was just that. I don't think it's just that, but I do think that a big chunk of what my thought process was on that was that when people come to the table and they may be cash strapped or they may not have, because it costs more than just $100,000 to license, it's a lot. And so I felt like when they pushed this money out, it was a gubernatorial attempt to justify what happened.
So what you're talking about, Mace, is the revolving loan fund.
Okay.
That's the confusion. There's a revolving loan fund that we established to ensure that folks had the ability to be able to get access to capital, because one of the things that we identified through the lead up work in advance of 2019, we were going and visiting with women like Wanda James, who was the only Black dispensary owner out in a Black woman who was in ownership out in Colorado. One of the major issues that many of the cannabinoids had, not just in Colorado, but in California, was the inability to get capital. So we created a revolving loan fund for folks to be able to access, and it's means tested, right? So again, everybody isn't coming in the game in the same space, in the same financial position. And so that opportunity is means tested. So people are going to have access to potentially get part of the startup costs for their businesses underwritten by the revolving loan fund.
So let me stop you there.
Which is separate from R3.
Okay, and I got to stop you right there because we got to take a quick break. But before I take a quick break, hey, y'all, don't forget, Sissy's Pop-Up Taco Bar is back every Thursday and Friday evening in January. Now stop by 312 East 75th Street, Thursdays and Fridays, from 6:30 to 9:30 p.m. for authentic street tacos made with Southside Soul. Sissy's makes the best jerk chicken, sriracha shrimp, blackened salmon, and don't forget the vegan jackfruit tacos, which are becoming the talk of the town. Now, I like the Rome walking taco. Plus, you can get Sissy street corn and children's meals that come with a special prize. Also introducing their tamales. Now, y'all know, Ruthie asked me about a green tamale? Sonia, Ruthie, your grandmama made tamales? Because I was just going to say, my grandmama never made tacos. I don't ever remember having tacos at the crib. Like,
man,
nobody...
now you know dang well we had ground beef tacos.
Oh, we used to go to
ground
Noggles.
Beef and cheese.
Oh, well, I'm going to tell you what. Go to Sissy's Taco Bar. Visit them at www.sissystacobar.com and sign up for text message updates to get a free taco on any purchase. Also, Sissy's looking for another location to pop up next month. So if you are interested in having Sissy come, then let us know. Y'all call into the Toure Muhammad show today, and you can talk to Sissy because she'll actually be in the studio.
Mace, do you eat lettuce on your tacos?
No.
Okay.
So, it depends. If it's Taco Bell taco, like,
those
if I'm trying to
tacos.
Have,
those
if I'm having Americanized taco, then yes. If I'm having if I make them at home, I might make an Americanized taco. But if I'm going to the store, I want steak, onions, cilantro, and maybe some cheese, right? Mm. And just roll with it like that. A little lime, squeeze it out, you be out.
What
good.
Kind of limes you got?
I don't know, man. You know, I get the peach limes. You got to squeeze them all hard. You know, limes done got expensive. All right, now also I want to remind you all, we got to protect Chicago. COVID-19 is ravaging our state and our country. There are vaccines. There's a lot of myths surrounding the vaccine. I'm not sure exactly where we sit on it, but what I do want to do is make sure that we get all the best information to you. Now, remember, stay 6 feet apart, okay? Also, wear your mask. And when you wear your mask, listen, I went to a place, man, This brother called his mask. You know how Nike got the zip-up suits? The zip-up that come to your nose? Mm-hmm. He gonna try and put his head down and make that the mask. I was looking around like, is you trying to kill every damn body?
I bet you ain't say nothing to him.
You know what? I didn't. You know why I didn't, though? Because he was looking like,
I bet you ain't gonna say nothing to me.
But that was my point. It was like, you really are like, this. It's not cute to take everybody's life. Like, right. So anyway, let me tell y'all, we got to protect Chicago. We got to protect our family. So y'all get y'all
It's like smoking
on.
A cigarette indoors. People will have a fit.
Well, you know what? It's going to be, I think it's going to turn into a social stigma issue. Mm. Like where people going to all just stare at you until you, right? Because it was funny because everywhere he walked, everybody moved away from him. Mm. It was like,
that happened to me. I walked into the store and I forgot my mask. Mm. I'm like, everybody's looking at me.
Everybody,
I'm
but
so
everybody
cute,
started going the other direction, moving mask. Away from him. Yeah. Hey, Lita, you know what? Lita Gordon, I saw y'all trying to flex down in Springfield with them masks, too. I see y'all done turning this into a fashion statement. Look, we're going to talk about all of this when we come back. Plus, we are going to open up the phone lines. Ruthie Moore's got a question. The phone lines are open, 872-259-7474. Let me do it again. Ruthie, do it because you say I do it too fast.
You do. Grab your pens, people. 872-259-7474.
Now, we are talking... Now, y'all know, they call you, you call them, they get on the show, and they be like, no questions. The phone lines are open. I don't want to hear none of that. I'm telling you, we're approaching a new era. We're having a cannabis conversation with Leader Jahan Gordon Booth. When we come back, Leader, though, I want to ask, you know, with your newfound bully stick, can we talk about a black wealth initiative? Right, with all of these black leaders and all of these people, can we put together a plan to get a black wealth initiative? I got some ideas on it. Plus, the people want to talk to you. We're going to do it all when we come back. It's the Maze Jackson Show.
The Maze Jackson Show. We'll be back after this break.
Hey, Chicago, you know we've all been impacted by COVID, especially in our communities. Help protect Chicago. We need everyone to stay safe and get the facts about the COVID-19 vaccine. Visit the What's in It for the Black People Media Facebook page and www.chicago.gov/COVIDVax for the facts.
I, Emmanuel Chris Welch,
do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear
that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
I ain't gonna hold the fact that he's an alpha against them. I'm not gonna hold the fact he came on my show with this Northwestern. But we made black history. The Illinois Speaker of the House, Mr. Emmanuel Chris Welch. Mr. Speaker, welcome to What's in It for the Black People Media. How are you today, and how does it feel to be one of the most powerful men in the state of Illinois?
I couldn't miss this opportunity to come on your show and talk about this historic moment. I've recognized exactly what this means for our people, and it was Black people uniting. Women in our caucus kicked the door down. They kicked it down, but Black people united and walked right through the door. In my governing, I think it's realistic for people to expect us to continue to pursue some important legislation that's going to impact Black communities, because that's been my entire career. I look at things through an equity lens, a racial lens, specifically a Black lens, and now that we're at the head of the table, we're going to make sure that our communities receive the much-needed resources that they need.
How do we actually get to participate now?
People may doubt what you say, but they believe what you do. And I'm in a position for the first time in the history of this state to help our community. And I want you to take a look at my actions and over the course of the next few months and see the answer to that very question. Want to see what's in it for the Black people? Watch my actions.
I must thank 22 strong people for insisting that that happen. Please acknowledge, respect, and thank the members of the Illinois House Black Caucus. Let's give them a round of applause.
I got that 10K the other day, but it's already gone away. I had some bills that I had to pay. I need my money. I roll the money. Y'all know the hustle.
know how we hustle. You know I gotta secure that bag, and you know I gotta hustle. Y'all know, 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 y'all know the hustle. Nigga gon' hustle. 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 Get that bag.
Listening to the most dangerous show in the morning. This is What's In It for the Black People Radio. Maze Jackson. Maze Jackson. The most vociferous advocate for black people in the world.
For the black people, cause economically we are not equal. Waking up to lies, can't doze no more. I told y'all, yeah, this is a dangerous show. Don't go to church if you ain't trying to help us. Don't even try to be around, it can't protect us. We see the lies, not other politicians. We need money and no symbolism. It's me, it's Sonya, and Ruthie and Ty. Explaining how we all come from God. Giving us tools to beat the odds. If we united, our movement gon' stop. If they ain't tryna help us, they ain't tryna do nothing. We gotta do something, we gotta stop running. It's time to confront the problem. Really, you expect you oppressed us all wrong.
Wake up, Chicago. Wake up, world. This is the Maze Jackson Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my co-host, Ruthie Moore, not to be confused with Boo and Oink. I got to say what's up to Sonya Escobar. And wake up, leader. Wake up. We seen you. Wake on up. Look, she got her hair all fresh. She letting us see the parts and everything. Look, you know, sometimes y'all ever seen them people that got parts, but it'd be like three fingers wide?
Nope.
Y'all ain't, yeah, look, nope. We seen Alita's part. She like, nope. My stuff extra fresh. I'm all good today.
But we be seeing y'all male comb overs.
I don't have a comb over. You see, that's why I let my girl go in. And we seen your husband love you to death. That's a big old, Jesus, what is that? Like, you know, that look like one of them Fred Flintstones. He putting it in. You there? Did we didn't lose you, did we?
She just ain't answering your question.
I can't hear her.
Can you hear me?
I got you. All right. We got
you. What
time do y'all go to bed? I go to bed at like 11:30 or 12 o'clock. Why you look like that?
She tired. I'm with her. It's early.
11:30, 12 o'clock every night. And then I'm up at 4. I drink this gallon of coffee.
So you're one of these people that don't need no sleep.
I'm starting to learn. You know, my wife was talking to me last night. I think it was a hint. Right? She was like, you know, you all were talking about how you know if you arrived or not. I think we need a sleep number bed. So I think.
Hold on. Wait. Because when the looting was happening, I told y'all that I was going to get a whole bunch of Tempur-Pedic mattresses, but nobody was with it.
No, we wasn't
nobody
with it.
Nobody was with it.
Nah, we was trying to get. She says, she didn't even say Tempur-Pedic, though. She said sleep number. Right? It's like, she was like, sleep. You know,
I'm
sleep
with
is
Carrie,
a.
Man.
You got
I'm
a sleep number?
Carrie all day. And I feel bad. Carrie got to have you hustling and bustling around the house at 4 o'clock in the morning while she's seeking her beauty rest, man.
I'm going to tell you. Can I tell you, though? I think I'm stealth. Like, I don't turn a light on. I don't move. The only time I think she probably really, well, she probably hears the shower. But I think I don't even turn on a light. Like, I won't even, like, open the bathroom door until the door is closed and she can't get hit with the light. But Yeah, I think she was trying to hustle me for a sleep number. Y'all, could y'all help me keep stay on the morning show and help me raise a sleep? Truthy, like, you better get your...
Just get a twin side. Just get her
look
one.
At you, what you know? Look, she said, send them some stars. Look at that. You know, leader Gordon Booth, you be talking like you listen to the Maze Jackson show or something. What's up with that? You trying to act like you got some background. You know, what you know about
us? You know how I listen to this show.
That is true. Can I tell you? She used to send me notes and be like, she would send me TD Jake stuff and be like, yo, you gonna be national. This is so, look. I mean, even in the heat of the moment, I get all these inspirational texts. She'd be like, man, I heard what y'all said today, so I'm gonna tell y'all. That's why I was excited to see that we were able to get the leader on. Mm-hmm. Leader, go back really quickly. I don't know if so. The president pro tem, does that. Do you now have a bigger stick? Let me just ask that. Because I know we talk about cannabis and you wanting to get some things done. I know you were very adamant in ensuring that there would be no new legislation unless the black folks were in. But tell me, does Speaker Welch, you as the Deputy Majority Whip, will that give us any additional political business leverage in relation to this cannabis thing, and how do we leverage that? Also want to let you know the phone lines are open. We got callers, so she will be taking calls. Go ahead, leader, I'm sorry.
So what I would say is all of this is new space, new runway, and territory for Speaker Welch and myself, right? These are new spaces that we're walking into. Clearly both Speaker Welch and myself, we're black folks who, have provided significant and, as you would say, vociferous advocacy for Black people in not just the cannabis space in Springfield, but bring our voices to the table on other issues as well. So how I see this shaping up is it's like anything else, right? We had the opportunity. This is a very, very unique moment. And it's not lost on me how we got here and what people are not just desiring and wanting, but are demanding from those of us that are in leadership positions. And so we have a unique opportunity in this moment, but I do think that it is going to require us, which is why it was exciting for me to kind of bookmark the end of this week by me being on Friday. You had Chris on Monday. You had my brother Cam on yesterday. I think it's important for us to open these lines of communication up so that we can actually have a much more a robust conversation with the community so that as we're working on things, the community needs to know, hey, these are the things that we're doing right now. We want your input. We value your voice. That is happening already, but it needs to happen. It needs to happen in this new space in a much more digital way. I'm aware of that. I think all of the other members of the caucus are aware of that. We're excited about it. And even though you talked about me in December,
I did. You won the award. You won an award.
You were so dirty for that, man.
It came. So sometimes it just popped in my head. I was like, who can we make? I didn't even have an answer, and I thought that was pretty clever.
Like 3 days in a row.
You know what? But it's because I did it in love, right? It's because, I'm going to tell you what, I have tremendous expectations of you. I'm not going to lie. Like, if there is anybody that, and quite frankly, even when it was, when there was whispers of there being a speaker before all of these other machinations, I was wholeheartedly in the leader, Jahan Gordon Booth, being a speaker and was vociferous about that. So I'm going to always, and I think it's important, know that I may not agree with what you did, but I'm always going to have your back. I tell people that I don't forget my friends. And there were very few people that were willing to communicate with me over these last 8 years and be straight up, right? And you were one of those people. So when someone says to me, hey, that such and such, such and such, I have no problem stepping up because I know that I'll hold your feet to the fire as well. And I think it's mutual. You know, if it's something bogus, you know you'll pick up the phone, yes, and be like, hey, dog, what you on?
I agree with you, which is why I didn't even reach out. But I will say this. One of the things you just said was what I did. You specifically said what I did. Mm-hmm. And I want to make it very clear that what I did was make sure that when you read that policy, that Black people knew that they had a place in this business.
what ended up happening was not a result of what I did or I negotiated or what we passed. That was a result of implementation not matching up with the legislative intent of what we were doing, which is why we have been, you know, 10 toes down on this issue since the very first day that since the scores were announced. So I want to be sure that the people know that those of us as Black Caucus members, myself, the folks that voted for this did not vote to create the current environment that we're in, which is why we have continued to push and press and advocate so that we get what it is that we intended. And I think that if we continue to keep these lines going, we're going to get there. We're going to get there because we have to, right? Like we made this commitment that we were going to see this through, and we got to do just that.
So we're going to hold the governors accountable, and we're going to be in your office talking. Let me say this. And when I say you, I think that one of my biggest concerns, and I'll always say, is that when we get white folks trying to create creative ways to say Black people without saying it, and you, the person who really informed me on this, quite frankly, was you, because the Latinos had a path by saying English speaking or something that meant it literally specifically reached out to them. And so I'm going to say that I think that the other part that we have to do is be very specific in our language in ensuring that we don't let them create loopholes in this social equity, which never said Black, and then every white person jumped on that. Ruthie's got a question for you.
All right. So I have a question related to Black people and cannabis. So we know right now the sort of the will of the people are making demands within the cannabis space. I wrote this down. We got folks having smokeouts. They boycotting the dispensaries. I don't think we went as far as to dump the weed in the Chicago River. Like,
ain't
the
nobody
Boston
dumping
Tea
Party. It because everybody be jumping in the water.
But,
ain't nobody dumping that.
Ain't nobody dumping it. But my question to you is, how do we bridge the gap between the will of the people who can actually make the demands, be a powerful voice? How do we bridge the gap between the people and the elected officials? Like, what type of supports do y'all need? Like, do y'all want people to go ahead and spark up in front of the white people dispensaries and smoke out? Do y'all want people to support their local dealers? Like, what do y'all need from the people?
Because I was going to say, I thought y'all might need somebody to put somebody in a trunk. Because these white boys don't seem to be getting it as they making their cartels. Look, don't make that face. You know we listen to Jay-Z. Go ahead.
So that sounds illegal. So, not touching that.
Okay.
But I would not suggest that either.
Okay.
But I would say that part of it is this, right? Like this engagement with you all, right? You have a powerful voice in the community. Having consistent engagement. Sometimes it's going to happen on the radio. Sometimes it may all not be able to happen on the radio, right? So being able to provide that level of transparency around what's happening and what's going on, and then using Black media to be able to have stronger relationships and communication. There are organizations that have been created. I don't think that's the organization Scene that you all had on at the end of December. I don't remember that organization being in the game back in 2019. I think that they are, I believe, don't get me, so right. Don't kill me if I'm wrong.
No, they were formed because of this.
Yes, they are a newer organization that came together as a result of this. So having the ability to connect with those organizations who are on the ground, who are supporting Black entrepreneurs that are in this space with the legislators is incredibly powerful. I didn't know, and listen, I'm in Peoria, so I don't know all of the various groups because we don't have cannabis groups in downstate Illinois, Black cannabis groups in downstate. So because I listened to the show, I was able to see Natasha. I then reached out to Maze, and then he made the connection between Natasha and myself just based on the common interest of wanting to make sure that, like, I'm hearing her voice. I'm hearing the concerns that she has. There are other organizations as well. We want to make sure that we're hearing from everybody because, you know, I know that there's a lot that gets said about the Black Caucus, but I'm going to tell you, the Black Caucus is always, always 10 toes down for Black people. And I don't know, somewhere along the road, like the narrative, I'm talking about the House Black Caucus. and the Senate Black Caucus, but right somewhere the narrative has gotten shifted a little bit. And I think that, again, we're in a space, and I was excited when Mays texted me at 5:15 this morning saying we were going to have a cannabis conversation, but we were going to be solutions oriented. Listen, you don't come on the Mays Jackson, Ruthie Moore show, Todd Strozier, when he's not in Jamaica, without being prepared for whatever the smoke the Lion's Den is going to bring. So I was completely prepared for that. But the reason why is because I think that we need to begin to have a broader conversation about the issue of cannabis, where the legislators are, where folks in the community are that want to play in this space, whether it be as an owner, whether it be someone who wants to play owner of a dispensary, the owner of a craft grow, the owner of a transportation operation or security operation. The issue of cannabis is going to continue to grow as it relates to delivery. And we begin to open up the delivery space. Think about it, like delivery won't likely have a license. Like not in the way that
hold on. We gonna be like New York where you could just hit the page and they can roll.
I pop the brakes. Not in the way that the dispensaries are licensed, right? So all of these spaces are going to look different. So what we want people to do is we want to have significant engagement. So even before something comes online, people can be thinking about the opportunities that are coming, not just the ones that are here today, but what are the opportunities 6 months from now, a year from now, so that people can begin to think about it and prepare themselves for those opportunities. So that's kind of how I'm thinking about this. And so I view, you know, this kind of engagement, the engagement with the folks on the ground, I don't think there should really be this gulf between us. I mean, we are representatives of the people, so people should always feel comfortable reaching out to us. But I think that the conversations do have to be elevated, and those conversations can be elevated through Black media.
You know what? So speaking of Black media, I just want to point out, while we probably are the only Black, truly 100% Black-owned media outlet that reaches over a few million people, we have essentially been frozen out of the state. Like even when you're talking about getting information out to people, what better place to come than What's In It for the Black People media, where we do provide trusted voices. And so part of the things that we want to do, and that's why I'm so adamant about us having these conversations and kind of tamping down, because when you talk about the narrative, I would say that we've had a tremendous part in shaping the narrative of an us against them kind of situation, because people haven't been able to necessarily understand what's going on, which is why this has got to happen. Let me do this. Let me open up the phone lines. I'm going to go to the callers. Caller, you are talking to the infamous JGB. She is leader, president pro tem, as well as state representative. What you got for me, caller?
Open up the phone lines. I'm going to go to the
caller.
Caller.
Caller. Caller, we're talking to you. Hello?
Good morning.
Come on, caller.
Yeah, I want to thank you guys. I just love it. I love it for Mays, Ruthie, and the whole family and the whole community. All because we talk about power and having Black power, and it's very much around Black wealth and Black generational wealth. And this is what you're talking about building. Not just in this area I want to speak here, but also at the same time right now as we speak, there is this electrical vehicle industry with self-driving cars that every and anybody can participate in. I'd like for you to shine a light on that also, for at the same time, while we can walk and talk and chew bubble gum and blow up the cannabis industry. And I like what you said about continuous on down the line to make us aware. So that's why I love this station. You're making us aware. We first have to be aware and then become wise, use that financial literacy of wisdom in making our wise decisions and how best to cover our rear end financially. I want to thank you ever so much.
Hey, you know what? Thank you, caller. And I want to thank Leader Gordon for being here. See, I think that what has to happen is, guys, they have the ability. Remember I told you how wealth is legislated? Right? Like, we have to kind of help them direct that legislation as to how we can most optimally fit And we got to stop being leveraged by other people to tell our story, because oftentimes the other people bring us to Springfield for their benefit. We saw that happen. Leader, one of the other things that's a big thing that I see on the horizon, did you know that Illinois has more gaming positions than Las Vegas? That we have become a gambling and gaming state. And one of the other things that I see happening is that we see these sports books, we see these casinos, we see the VGT operators, and every single one of them has figured out a legislative way to keep us uninvolved in the industry. How do we work with the legislature to create space in the gaming place? Not so we're doing napkins and selling trinkets and trash, but we are literally participating in the industry. I look around and I see in our communities, everybody else profiting off of gaming opportunities except us. How do we get in?
So you and I had this conversation back in the beginning of the cannabis space, and here's the reality. We need Black trade organizations that are specific to these industries, or people that want to be in these industries. There's a lane for everybody, right? We are legislators. People that want to be in the business space, they're entrepreneurs, they're business folk. And so the way that those relationships work best, as you know, is you have the legislator that's in relationship to someone who is on the other side of the equation, and they then become the experts in that space. And based on being the expert in that arena, they're bringing you the information to say, hey, here's what we need. Here's how it should look. Here's how they're going to try to get around it. And there's work that the legislator has to do on the legal side as well, in order to ensure that that language is drafted in a way that protects the interests that we're looking to advance. But ultimately, there is no space that's off limits in terms of us finding our way to cut our piece of the pie. But I think what we have to be more intentional about as a community is finding the ability to work together and identifying those folks who have specific interests in those spaces. Because as you know, the gaming space, cannabis space, the insurance space, healthcare, all of these industries have what that supports them? A lot of money. And anytime you're talking about industries where there's a lot of money, you're going to have people that are always looking for loopholes, always looking to advance their own interests. So we have to have our people working in the exact same way in conjunction with our legislators. And so, you know, I know you heard my brother, Curtis Tarver, Representative Tarver, Woo! Last week, brought all the smoke.
Yes, he did.
When it came to advancing legislation that wasn't necessarily a disadvantage to us, but you know, without even going too far into it, but the reality of it was there was a group that was working against the interests of what we were trying to advance at that time. There's always interest, somebody's interest on the table. So what Rep Tarver got up, he had the wherewithal to hop up on the mic. And as soon as he started talking, everybody listen. And we knew it was almost like a bat signal.
Yeah,
we were all around. We were in various places on the floor. When he got up and he started talking, it was like the bat signal went up, and then everyone went back to their positions. Like, okay, it's time to mount up. And that's the mentality right now. And so we're in a great space is basically what I'm getting at. So there is no opportunity that we can't advance right now. We just got to work together to do it.
Now that goes to, and I got callers, so don't hang up. You know what that goes to, leader, that I don't really think that we as Black folks truly recognize. I was involved in politics for freaking 20 years. And it wasn't until a white guy and a Latino guy who needed relationships with the Black caucus called me and said, hey, we want to hire you to come lobby in Springfield. And I learned about the whole role of lobbyists and the negotiations and the process that gets us to where we get to. And I also know that it was a closed system. It was a closed network. If you were black and you wanted to lobby to talk to black people, you usually had to go to somebody white to get put on. Because even if you did lobby, the cost of coming down to Springfield, et cetera, was not something that we had. Let me ask you, as we talk about moving these things forward, will you all create a space, and will black lobbyists have an opportunity to really advance the business of black people down there? It doesn't have to be a white lobbyist, or can black people finally hire some black lobbyists to get some black work done?
So based on what I'm hearing, people are scrambling, trying to find black lobbyists right now based on this new world order that we have over here in the house.
So let me just give my, can I give my phone? One more time, the phone number is 872-259-7474. If you're looking for a lobbyist, Ruthie is for hire. No, I'm just joking. Well, she likes you.
I do have a consulting business, if anybody's interested.
I'm going to tell y'all what. I think that there is a new
day. I always
day.
Love Ruthie's perspectives, too. She would be a great person to hire for a whole number of issues.
I'm going to tell you, it is really one of my missions to connect the dots with Ruthie and the people like yourself, because I do believe that there are young people in the world that could really move the ball forward and could be helpful in this space. And I do think that Ruthie is very persuasive. But I do want to make sure, because one of the things that I've been noticing right now, Leader, is that a lot of the white firms are now offering jobs to black people just so they can have somebody on the deck. Because the fact of the matter is, and I've seen this happen, where the white guys hire black people because we ain't going to never make no $150,000, $200,000. And then they take those black people and leverage them, and you all want to see them become successful. And then they wind up making the white guys a couple million dollars. I just want to encourage you all to help us develop a group of young, or not just young, but black lobbyists that can be as successful without having to give up their credibility to the white guys to get the check. And I'm seeing it happen already, and I just hope that we can prevent making us indentured servants to the lobbying business again.
You know, see, a lot of, see, Maze was unique. There are very few people, black or white, that get into the lobby game that don't have some kind of Springfield connection, whether they were a staffer, they worked on campaigns, and they came into, you did that as well. But like, there is typically a path that people ultimately become lobbyists. One of those paths is having served on staff. In my estimation, staffers oftentimes make the best legislators, and they make the best lobbyists, because their perspective is a bit more well-rounded, particularly staffers that work campaigns. I can tell you for a fact that there is a very specific interest. There's going to be more black staff moving forward in this new Speaker Welch administration, without a doubt. Even many of the staffers that are on staff right now are, in particular, young men that Chris has mentored, that interned for him, that, matter of fact, my staffer is a Speaker Welch intern from a few years ago. And so he has been building a pipeline of young people that he's been working with. And, you know, he has the connection to Northwestern and other institutions of higher education in the Chicago area. So he has a stronger pipeline. You know, when you move into some of the other smaller communities, like in my area, we only have Bradley University. You don't have as many that necessarily want to go into that space, but particularly now in the last 4 years since Trump, there is a heightened desire for young people to be involved in the political space. And so rather it's through building a stronger pipeline and bench through bringing on more black staff, or whether it be bringing people who have a specific interest and desire and have know-how and experience in a specific lane, niche, or space, or people who have a strong degree of relationships with members. There are a lot of lanes for people to become for people to become lobbyists. And so I think that this new environment that we find ourselves in is going to be positive in a lot of different ways. And having more black faces around Springfield. There's only going to be one of them.
Let me freeze you right there, because I had a special request, a musical request that we are about to fulfill right now. We're going to take a quick break. But, you know, if you have anybody that happens to like the What's In It For The Black People Stepper song and they would like to speak to a few thousand people, or if you'd like to showcase that mama part of you, you are more than welcome to bring her on camera. But we are going to play the What's In It For The Black People theme song, because apparently someone in the Gordon Booth household is a fan. So Tyrone Tate, for Representative Leader Gordon. Leader, tell me the baby's name one more time.
Gianna.
Gianna, let me tell you, if Gianna is around, we are playing this song. We are stopping the whole show because you gave us your mama for 3 hours. So, ladies and gentlemen, right now we are going, and callers, we still got you, but we are going to make a special dedication to Gianna and What's In It For The Black People. Sonia, hit it.
Gigi, come here. They playing your song. Come on. Are you gonna be shy? Huh? They playing a song. Ooh, the hair. Lay this hair down. You gonna dance? It's something like that. Don't stick your tongue out. For the black people. You gonna smile? Show me the teeth. Show me the teeth. Girl, come on. All right, then go. Go. What's in it for the black people? Let's hear it. What's in it for the black people? There we go. All right, okay. You can go back. Let's hear it. What's in it for the black people? Don't fear it. For the black people. 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 What's in it for the black people? You know it. What's in it for the black people? Let's show it. What's in it for the black people?
You know it. What's in it for the black people? Let's show it. For the black people. For the black people. For the black people. For the black people. For the black people, 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 for the black people. All right, y'all. Don't forget, Sissy's Taco Pop-Up Bar is back every Thursday and Friday evening in January. Stop by at 312 East 75th Street, Thursdays and Fridays from 6:30 to 9:30 for authentic street tacos. Ruthie, you eat street tacos? Not really.
It depends on what street I'm
on. What street you on? Right. All right, well, I'm going to tell y'all what. The street tacos, that's the business, y'all. We got the authentic street. Hold on. I'm trying to get all my stuff together. 1, 2, 3. All right.
And I got a question.
Okay, so you're going to let you talk, and then we got phone calls too, so we're going to make sure you get your question. But before that, don't forget Sissy's makes the best jerk chicken, sriracha shrimp, blackened salmon, and the Cajun jackfruit tacos, which are becoming the talk of the town. Now, don't forget about the Rome walking tacos, Sissy street corn, and children's meals that come with a special prize. Also introducing tamales. That's right, tamales. Yeah, but you got to pre-order, bro.
Oh, my goodness.
Was that wrong?
That was wrong.
Okay, well then visit Sissy's Taco Bar and sign up at sissystacobar.com and sign up for text message updates to get free taco with any purchase. All right, y'all. On the live line, look, I keep telling you, the leader be putting her head down so y'all can see.
She be looking at her phone.
And she wants y'all to know she ain't got one of them three finger parts. You ever seen them sisters with the three finger parts?
Stop.
You be like, stop. Golly, how many parts y'all got?
Like that in the hair. It's a lot going on with the hormones and everything else. We're not going to be coming for people's parts.
Representative Booth, you know, since they got them new hair treatments, men just.
Girl.
LeBron to hype them up and gave them hope.
Right, we know all about it.
Okay, that is funny. Okay, so since we on this, and I know Ruthie, you got questions, we gotta go.
Yeah, it's pretty lighthearted. It's pretty lighthearted though.
Okay, so before we go, because this is tell me something good. Just tell me something good Friday too.
And you got Ruthie, your lemonade.
You go first.
Okay, so this is the question that I have lemonade. For you. So, you know, as a person who's from Kankakee County, that's considered to be like a little bit downstate, right? And you know, people from Chicago. They will never let you be from Chicago if you ain't from Chicago. Yeah. So this is my question as a fellow downstater. Do you think Chicago has too much political power?
I mean, does Chicago have a lot of political power? Yes. And they have a lot of political power because Cook County has the largest population by far in the state. But I will say this. When you want to pass, as it relates to policy measures. Let me say this. If you want to pass something controversial, when I'm talking to, you know, individuals that are looking to advance some policy, I always let them know, like, if you want to pass something controversial or significant, your issue isn't Chicago. Your issue is going to be getting the representative or the senator from Kankakee, from Peoria, from Decatur, from Danville, from DuPage County. Those are the people who you're going to have to build a coalition with to get things done, because Chicago alone cannot do it. But just as a sheer, when we're talking about electoral politics, sheer muscle, listen, we saw that with Pat Quinn. Pat Quinn won Cook County and St. Clair County and won the governor's race.
102 counties, he won two and was done.
In one race.
In one.
And that is what it is. We can't do anything about it. Mm.
All right, we're going to lighten it up a little bit. But we're going to take some calls, too. But since we're in a lighthearted place, you know I got to be a little messy.
Always.
Leader Gordon Booth, Vice President Kamala Harris, if she was your girl, because I've seen you before. I've seen how you kind of roll out. I've seen how you kind of swaggy, you know, with your dress and you know, I see you in session days. You always put together, you know what I'm saying? You don't got I was going to say something else. I'm going to leave it alone. You don't got the shiny weave, right? You know, you got the whole thing together. Do you see the Vogue cover? Would you that's your girl. Would you have let her go with the Vogue, with the chucks, with the curtain and the thing in the back? Or would you say, sis, it's Vogue? I just need to know. I'm just trying to get an opinion.
So here's the thing. We now live in this era where people don't want their celebrities or their politicians to be way up here. You want to feel like even president and vice president of the United States, we want people who feel accessible, who feel like I know that person. I mean, let's take a step back for a minute, right? Let's think about Jay-Z and Beyonce, and I'm going somewhere with this.
Okay,
they used to have so much mystery around them. They wouldn't even claim each other, but you would see them together. Then as time evolved, people were all celebrities, all public officials have been forced to open themselves up a little bit more and come off more relatable. And so I would say that part of Kamala's, you know, strategy, because everything is a strategy at that level. Ain't nothing happened by accident. Part of the strategy in wearing the Timbs and wearing the Chucks is so that you can meme it and TikTok it and try to feel more connected to the culture, more connected to the community. So I don't necessarily think it was a bad idea from the standpoint that part of her strategy is to come off more relatable. As you both know,
Kamala has had some issues in terms of connecting to our community in the past, whether it was real or perceived, there were some connection issues. And so the Tims and the Chucks, maybe she wore them before she was hopping off the private jet, but was she, you know, wearing them regularly and having memes taken? Probably not. So I think from a strategy perspective, I think it was fine. Do I think that that should have been the cover? Absolutely not. It was something that should have been on the inside of the article, you know, when they're talking about maybe some, you know, her workout, you know, or what she does for self-care or whatever, right? Something that's not necessarily Washington, D.C. or policy driven, but maybe something that's a little bit more personal. Maybe they would have had that picture inserted around text that was around, that was looking to drive home. Hey, I know her. She's somebody who I look like. Oh, I got those same trucks. I have that same suit.
Let me ask a question. Do you wear Chucks any other time besides a special event? I didn't say your daughter. You. Because I say black people don't really wear Chucks unless they go into a party. They got to have an outfit specifically for the Chucks. You ain't just waking up on a Saturday being like, you know, let me put on my Chucks. When last time you wore some Chucks that wasn't to somebody's Chuck and such party?
I do not wear Chucks as a general matter.
Exactly.
But I've been, she's from Cali.
Okay, so she crip walked up.
People from Cali do wear, think about how long consistently Snoop Dogg has worn Chucks.
Okay, I'll give you that. That was Tucson's argument that it was a West Coast thing.
The question is, does she wear Tims?
No, she don't wear no Tims. You know she ain't wear no Tims, but somebody had her feeling real swaggy when she, let me tell you, okay? Let me tell you, and I know people was thinking that the swag was because of the Tims. No, the swag was, I'm getting off this private jet. Because I'm telling you now, no matter.
With the Tims on.
Right. The fact that you flying a private jet with Tims means that I have basically taken the ultimate of white success. Because if you ain't making $20 million a year, you shouldn't own a jet. Like, really. No, you shouldn't. $20 million is what you need to be making to have it. So I'm going to tell you, everybody would have got off that plane with some swag. Anybody black would have. I'm just going to tell you. You can see pictures of me getting off the plane. They didn't even go nowhere. And I was like, let me get my swag on. All right, y'all. This is really good. Let me do this. I'm going to go to the live lines because you got a couple calls, leader. Can I ask, though, before I do this, can we get a commitment that this won't be a last?
For sure. Can we do 7 to 9?
Hello.
And you know what? And here's the deal. There's a couple things. It doesn't even have to be 3 hours. I mean, we can take a half hour. Right? Like, I think this was important because I think there's a lot of barriers we got to break down, right? And I'm going to tell you, like, for all of the smack that I've talked about cannabis, I think people need to understand, like, who y'all are, right? Like, I mean, it's like Leader Gordon was somebody, like, when I was in Springfield, that we would be like, man, this going to change one day, right? And to see it all come to fruition, and everybody had a role in it, pushing. And even I even said that I thought that the speaker rewarded the loyalty that I dogged people for years, right? And that could have very easily been put together where it wasn't a black speaker, and we didn't have the opportunity for people like Leader Gordon, like Leader Buckner, even Chris Welch, who has held Speaker Welch, who has held white folks' feet to accountable. Now we just want to open up the doors to make sure that the black folks don't have to go become indentured servants to the Bill Filins and all of the white guys that are probably right now trying to figure out where can they rent them a Negro from. We want
to
make
I want to give a real quick shout out to my brother, former leader Art Turner.
Woo!
And Larry Lester.
They have
created the first all black lobby firm in Springfield. And I think that Larry is a hustler, hard worker. He was a Senate staffer. I think he followed you as
twice.
Because
he went from the caucus, and he, when he went to go lobby initially, he took the spot that the black lane that I just got in trouble. Go ahead.
Yes, right. And so he works campaigns. You have Art, who was a deputy majority leader in the House, who really grew up in Springfield. He knows everybody, has wonderful relationships with everybody. And they have an all-black firm, the first all-black firm in Springfield's history. And so I want to give a big shout out to them because they are a premier lobby firm in Springfield. And Blue they're chip. The first, but it certainly shouldn't be the last.
Well, I'm just going to tell you, we trying to send Todd back down there, right? He was a former member. Look, look, leader, there is two sides. When I lobbied, what I recognized is that there's two sides to every issue, every single issue. And it seems like in lead, there should be black people at the table, not sitting outside in the hallway waiting to go get the votes, but should be putting it together, knowing that there is going to be a need for a black perspective in all of these bills that are coming forth. Let me go to the live line. David, you're on the Maze Jackson Show, and you got leader Jahan Gordon Booth, the infamous JGB, on the line. David?
Hello?
Hello, I did that big wind up, and he like, hello. David, you're on the live line.
Can y'all hear me?
Yes, we can. David.
Hey, how y'all doing, man? My name is David. I'm from Oakland, California. I just moved to Chicago. I've been in the cannabis space for 5 years, operating in D.C., Boston, and New York. I'm just learning about how, you know, for lack of better words, interesting the industry out here is. And one of my questions that I have, I got a bunch, but one of the questions that I had was, when is the next round of applications for specifically delivery and craft grow coming out? Because it seems like a lot of things have been stalled.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Leader Gordon, he is asking, when is the craft grow license going to come out? Because I know that a lot of black people and even minorities have minority stakes or larger stakes in the craft grow business, which is the another opportunity for us to be in control of our destiny. Are we going to still be operating with the same J.B. Pritzker rules that we did last time that will squeeze us out? How do you anticipate craft grow?
So first of all, as we talked about earlier in the show, there were a lot of irregularities as it related to scoring that were identified after on Beyonce's birthday. that's why that day will live in infamy forever. There were a number of inconsistencies that were identified through the retail, which is obviously the dispensary lane. And then so before some of these other opportunities were let, there was a deeper dive that went into those spaces. And so retail as well as craft go is going to have some deficiency notices that will go out. I don't know when that specific date is, but people will have the ability to go back and see if there's any deficiencies in scoring. Before we have situations where we have some of the same irregularities that we saw in the scoring with the dispensary round. So I would say I don't have a specific date, but it won't be long.
Okay. And so should I take from that they looked and they didn't get a good response from what they did, and so now they got to go back and look some more and make sure
Because again, I'm not in the administration. Right. Okay. So I'm on the legislative side. So I don't know what they're seeing. Right. Okay. We're not allowed to be in that element and that's on that side of the table. So there's a very real gulf in separation, which is important as it relates to what scoring and things like that are looking like and what it is that we see. Know some of and a big shout out to my sister, senior advisor to the governor, Toy Hutchinson.
ILL.
Absolutely. Toy is black to the bone. She wants what you want, what Ruthie wants, what I want, and what all the rest of us want, which is to see black people in this industry. And so I think one of the things that we can also do is have stronger communication as it relates to how do we make sure that we're not viewing when we get a person in a spot, that we don't allow like some of these larger narratives to take over these people who we know, right? So, and who we know have our interests. And so
but our people gotta talk to us, right? They gotta say, this is where we at. And it's like, it can't be, he's off limits. When you know that realistically, we can't let white people pick who our black friends are going to be. And that's where I'm at with this. That's why we're going to do this. Last question.
We're going to be a big family moving forward.
That's what I'm talking about, right? You got somebody that they don't get to do it to you in secret, right? The thing that I think helps us is the fact that these things don't happen in the cover of dark, but that we have our own outlets to be able to tell our own stories and shape our narratives. Frank, I know you've been holding. You got to do it quick because I only got a minute. So you got 1 minute, okay. Frank. Come on.
I'm going quick. Good morning to all y'all. And State Representative, thank you for sitting in and having a darn long double thank you. You are a godsend, okay? I'm in overwhelm with everything I'm hearing you said. So my comment came in a form of a request. Please, and residents throughout the rest of the party, please do not let someone, you know what I'm saying, convince you that you're doing too much for black people. Even if they're a black person, don't listen to them. With the devastation happening to our community, there's no such thing as doing too much for black people. We have absolute power to fix everything. Don't run with our community. So don't be stopped and get flipped on. Now they get y'all the power. You should say fix it. You can't get flipped on us Redskins. Don't listen. No one want to tell you. You're doing too much for black people.
Thank you, Frank. I'm gonna tell you. I would tell you what. Leader Gordon, in my knowledge of her, has never let anybody tell her that she's doing too much for black folks, black people. Y'all done got me acting like I'm on the South Side. black people. But I think it was important today for us to be reintroduced to our legislators, but not only our legislators, our leaders. And I think we gotta figure out how do we rebuild that bridge between us? Because it's in my estimation, it's 5 pillars at a minimum. They hit 3 of them this last go-round. Now we got to figure out how do we work together, solutions-based, to bring black wealth. And I'm gonna tell y'all, I'm gonna be on this black wealth initiative.
Unapologetically.
Absolutely. Look, as Sonya said, I got 3 more minutes. Leader Gordon Booth, you have been with us for literally 3 hours.
Ooh, I don't know how you made it, girl.
But what I'd love to do is give you the opportunity to close us out. You got about, I'm gonna give you a minute and 90 seconds. Can you say anything you wanna tell the people that we need to know?
Well, first and foremost, I want to thank you, Maze, and you, Ruthie, for giving me this opportunity and giving the platform to be able to have a much more direct conversation with black folks, not just in the city of Chicago, but you all have a very deep reach. You go all over the state and oftentimes all over the country. So thank you for sharing your platform with me this morning. I know that black folks are yearning for black leadership that will unapologetically advocate on behalf of issues as it relates to the African-American community. And I can tell you that that day is here. I think that what you saw happening in Springfield a week ago was just the beginning as it relates to how we are going to use our ability as not the majority, because again, black folks are not the majority. We have a large voting bloc when we vote unified, when we use our unity and we use it for the advancement of black folks, we can get things done. And we are living through a space and a time because of the young people, right, that took to the streets this summer. One of the things that Ruthie always says, Ruthie's like, burn it down. and I love that spirit. I love that spirit because part of what she's not meaning light a match. What she's saying is oppressive systems that have existed for a long time. It is time to break those systems down and rebuild systems that work for everybody, and specifically that work for black folk. And so I want you all to know that you got 22 members of the Illinois Legislative Black Caucus that are 10 toes down as it relates to being on the front lines of policy in the state of Illinois and our state capitol, wanting to make sure that we are doing what our people are sending us there to do, and that is to reshape and reimagine what it is like to be black in Illinois. So I'm excited for this opportunity. I'm excited, I'm honored and humbled to have the ability to be in a leadership position. I'm only in this position because of my colleagues, and so I thank them, I honor them, I appreciate them. I thank black folks for having our backs. We need you with us. The idea that there's been a gulf that has existed. I'm glad that we're working to break down those walls, Because I'm gonna be honest with you, there is nothing that we can't accomplish if we're working together. And that's not naive, that's not pie in the sky, that's the reality. And so last week was just the tip of the iceberg on what I think we're gonna have the ability to do. So thank you so much, and I've enjoyed being with you this morning.
Man, we have appreciated you being with us, and this will not be the last time. I want to remind you all, the last day for Sissy's Tacos is today, 312 East 75th, 630 to 930.
At the location, yeah.
At the location. Now, they are looking for a new location, so if you're looking for a pop-up partner, don't miss Sissy's Tacos. Look, y'all, I think we did the damn thing this week. On our interviews, on the people that we had. Let me say thank you to Sonia Escobar. Let me say thank you to my co-host, Ruthie Moore. Todd, get off of that daggone vacation.
Bring me some White Henny.
Everybody go to Jamaica want some daggone White Henny back. I also want to thank... Did you say bring you a husband? You know,
I said that, I apologize.
I want to thank Speaker of the House, Chris Welch, House Black Caucus Chair, Cambium Buckner, who has been with us before, and I am grateful for the opportunity to introduce you all to who I consider my good friend legislatively, and I look forward to working to move What's in It for the Black People forward and answer that question all the time, What's in It for the Black People. Leader, President Pro Tem, and Speaker Pro Tem, State Rep, and Leader Jahan Gordon Booth. Look, y'all. This is the Maze Jackson Show. So for Maze and Sonia and Ruthie and where's Todd? I am the host of the Maze Jackson Show, asking every single day, what's in it for the Black people? And if you don't like it, you can still tell them.
Jahan said.
We out of here.
Maze said. Look around here. These daggone women always trying to take over everything. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned for the Book of Dawn.
Thank you. Introducing your trusted source for high-quality Black emojis, better known as Blackmoji. We believe Black is beautiful, and that beauty should be reflected in the digital market. Now there is an app that does just that, starting with Black Greek letter organizations. Blackmoji D9 offers more than an emoji app. It is a cultural experience of Black excellence. Download the app in the Apple or Google Play Store to access a specially curated catalog of emojis representing the Divine Nine. Use the emojis to celebrate Black Greek events, acknowledge current events, support social causes, and learn about esteemed Black Greek members who blaze the trail of Black history.
A portion of every subscription goes toward a scholarship fund specifically for members of Black Greek letter organizations to help keep the legacy alive. Download the Blackmoji app today.
Good morning, sunshines. Good morning, Nephew Ron.
Good morning, TT.
Let me just first say this. Thank God it's Friday.
Friday,
it's freestyle. And we've got Dr. Heather Prendergrass waiting in the wings. So I'm going to be quick about this so that I'm respectful of the doctor's time. But remember, I told you we're going to bring her back so we can ask Dr. Heather any questions we have about anything. But specifically, we're going to talk about COVID because she now is one of the people that has already had the vaccine. My sister had it as well. I think they had two different versions, but they both are in the health business, and both sisters and are doing well. So I think we need to see what everybody's afraid of about this vaccine. There's so many myths. We're going to maybe see if Heather can dispel some of the myths about the vaccination. But Nephew, I wanted to say thank you.
What?
For work, you know, for helping me for getting my get right together.
No, it's no problem.
It's a family thing. It's the shoe game. Today is Friday, January in my black speak, 22nd. Happy birthday to yesterday. I missed it, to the homie Eric Wilkinson, Rita Arnold, Phil Strong, Yatasha Womack, Craig Barnes, that's a Luther South Brave, Kelly Briggs, Luther South, Dory Collins, happy birthday. My cousin, Kelly Longmire. Happy birthday 2 days in advance to the boss lady. Tennille Jackson's birthday is in 2 days, so I won't be here Sunday, so I have to tell her that now. My niece, Sindel DeBerry, Pastor Michael Neal, and Genesis Reynolds. It is right now like 16 degrees and the high is 20, so dress warm.
Or stay inside if you ain't got one. Be still, like my TT said.
Be Don't I tell you to be still?
All the time.
Be still. If I could tell my 30-year-old self anything, I would say, sit down and be still. Not sit, sat. We are going to take a quick break because I want to swap out and bring Dr. Heather in so we can get started. We'll be right back. Stay tuned to the Book of Dawn on the What's in It for the Black People Media. I am she. She is me. I'm Dawn. Happy Friday!
WIFTBPN. The Chicago Legal Network is the collaboration of attorneys that concentrate in many areas of the law most needed in Chicago neighborhoods. The CLN lawyers focus on personal injury, criminal defense, and other issues. The CLN lawyers all average over 20 years of legal experience and are dedicated to helping the Chicago community. The Chicago Legal Network is committed to developing black lawyers through mentorship and co-representation. So if you were injured in a car accident, slip and fall, or injured on the job, or you need assistance with criminal defense, including driving violations and DUI, check out ChicagoLegalNetwork.com for more information or call 773-912-3545. 773-912-3545.